pick and ban for game one. The question is, are we going to see that Azir ban? Okay, well, there it goes.
No Ezreal allowed is what CJ decided. It's definitely the big ban. I got a big asterisk on my stat sheet here to just really ban out that Ezreal and just see what our Spenno have to show, because that's been the big commonality in their two recent wins. It's getting that champion, smarter shot calling, letting them get to the late game, and Runeglaive Ezreal, enough said.
Yeah, precisely. So now Spenno taking a while to figure out their draft in this particular game. What are we going to see them ban out? It will be the Kalista. Not too big of a surprise. We so rarely see that get through the pick and ban. The only time in recent memory was actually yesterday when we did see Kalista fall into the hands of Anarchy, but that did not result in a win.
Yeah, Anarchy, I believe Sungyun has a negative win rate, maybe 1-3 with that champion, so maybe just a calculated play or ban in that case by Samsung. Waiting to see if Spenu just target, you know, the carries, the Coco in space, these are the only common players from the strongest possible CJ Enders lineup. Or do they actually have a read on the likes of Helper, Trick, and Max? Do you even ban the Rumble that had one impressive performance and then one really shaky one?
Or the Gnar, too. Gnar is a great catch-all pick against a lot of laners, and especially for lane matchups. And Helper's Gnar was good in team fights. There's no question about that. He synergized very well with Madlife's Alistar in terms of chaining CC.
And it's 5-12 still. I mean, people have been talking about the 5-13 Graves, but a 5-12 Graves ban to space. Played it twice, one win, one loss. Interesting champion, but to actually absorb a ban.
This tells me that Spenu may want to actually play Sivir here, because that is what Space likes to pick the Graves into, just so he can have that very dominant laning phase and just kind of create the snowball from there. Certainly not a high damage late game carry in terms of consistent damage over the course of team fights, but potent early on. There's a Nidalee ban up against Trick. So one of the Nidalee bans that we see, it's more of a pocket ban here in Korea just because there are only specific Nidalee players, and will they go ahead and take that Rumble first for Helper? It's a lot left on the board. Gragas still available. Alistar still up.
We get little bits of information about these subs just by the order in which the picks are taken. Okay, Rumble is a quite standard first rotation pick, but do they feel pressured to pick one of Max's champions? Do they feel pressured to pick one of Trick's champions in the next rotation and aren't confident enough to go for that counter pick later in the draft?
Yeah, that is the big question. Okay, Kassadin and Nocturne hovered over.
Mid Nocturne played in the LMS recently. Chaoui smashing on that champion, so we can dream.
Well, we see Nocturne top in the LCS. We see Nocturne jungle in several different regions now.
Not a lot of winning, though.
No, well, he's not. It's not very good. Though.
No.
I remember when CJ used to play Nocturne mid as a TF counter. That was pretty funny. But Azir will be locked in for Sassen and the Alistar. So taking that away from Coco in the pick phase as opposed to directly banning it out. So where's Coco going to go here? He certainly has a very wide champion pool. He's proficient on Victor if he needs to play that in this game.
You know who I'm hoping for, Monte Cristo? Maybe it's Jace time.
I would love to see
Rumble in the top lane. What better time?
We have never seen the reworked Jace in Korea.
Oh, Coco's flashing an Irelia counterpick. Of course, we saw Faker pull that out to much aplomb against Ku earlier in the season. No real pressure to lock in that champion so far. But yeah, saw some magic damage in the top. Magic damage jungler, okay, mostly a tank, but still decent base value of damages. Now we're seeing Corki be flashed as well. Smells like a Jace to me.
It would make a lot of sense of this composition, and certainly might be a strong pickup here. I would love to see it. The great thing about the Gragas Jace synergy is you can just blow somebody up, have him go into hammer stance where he does a tremendous amount of damage and one-shot somebody in isolation, or you have that option to disengage with all the poke that they have. I agree, this is a very strong composition for Jace or another poke mid lane champion. Also, with the amount of AP, it would make it harder to itemize against. Corki just going to be the standard pick for space pretty much in any composition, though. So CJ, they've got a lot of different ways they can go with this right now. They really don't have to commit to one style.
Sure.
It does make Spenu's draft a little bit harder.
I mean, Coco, it feels like AD is the big source of need from the mid lane that he needs to fill. Zed is another champion that does well in the laning phase, but probably not expecting a Coco Zed to come through. So it does feel like it's shouting out for that burst AD threat in Jace. A lot of it's very execution heavy when you're talking about Rumble, Gragas, Jace, if they do lock it in, because, you know, negative synergy between displacement and Rumble ult. Okay, if you can get the perfect isolation burst off, that can work really well as well. We're waiting in trepidation to see where does Coco go, because it feels like if he locks in Victor, we're really magic damage heavy, and he's locked in the Jace.
Yep, Janna Jace will be it, so...
Poke time!
Yeah, this composition, really exciting. Of course, we do refer to Coco as Korean Sniper. He's had some amazing Jace games this year.
So this is his first game on the rework Jace?
Yes. It's the first game in Korea on the rework
Jace.
Wow,
I didn't even appreciate that. I thought there must have been one game around. I feel like the rework Jace, I know you were kind of really hesitant to call it buff. I think this is a straight buff. I think a lot of what he did before, okay, maybe you don't push down towers as fast, you don't get that level, the leveled up W as early, but the EQ, the poke, certainly buffed up.
He's definitely stronger in the late game. I mean,
sure,
there's no debating that, right? But the question is, he just takes a long... They basically just smoothed out his power curve is what happened to him. So he does take a little bit of a hit to his early game, but his potency in the late game is greatly improved. So he's kind of, obviously there are a lot of comparisons between him and Varus. I prefer Jace to Varus just personally, but if we look at that mid-game power spike, that's where Varus is going to be stronger in comparison to Jace. But late game, that switches up. So it will be the Sivir lock-in.
Yeah, Spenu, very balanced engage comp coming through with the likes of Sivir. I'm not a big fan of the Sivir Azir just because Azir feels better when he's cutting backwards, and this team is all about getting in the face. But if you can get on top of Jace in particular, he's the most immobile of this CJ Entis lineup. You can definitely take the team fight win if you spend a very balanced lineup with tankiness, damage, and that on the hunt for the engage.
Yeah, and Spenu absolutely can fight this poke comp. When we think about their engage so far, they have two forms of heavy primary engage, Maokai and Alistar. They have, if Sol can pull off the TP flanks, he can definitely get on that back line. And there's not the most peel in the world for CJ Entis. They've got some good displacement with Gragas and Janna, but that may still not be enough to stop both Maokai and Alistar from getting back there. So I love the fact that we're seeing CJ go with this poke composition. When we think about CJ as a team, they have always been good at kite and poke compositions. It has been one of their strengths. Now, whether that has translated to three new substitutes, that's the question. Has this style that certainly we know Shy, Ambition, and Madlife to use very well been imprinted onto these substitutes? Is that how they've been trained? Well, let's get into game one, CJ versus Spenu. Okay, so the mostly substitute lineup of CJ takes the Rift here up against the starting lineup, what we see most of the time from Spenu Sonic Boom. What can they do in this one?
The crazy thing to me is, I think you alluded to this in your explanation, you take away the names. This is a very CJ Entis comp, but with three new substitutes, is it still going to have the same flavor? We were waiting to see this from their starting lineup, so it's just really curious to see them, you know, change up the lineup, but still play a very CJ Entis poke comp.
Right, and I guess what confuses me, Papa Smithy, is why now?
Exactly.
With the Jace, why now? Out of all those times, we've always had that question, where is the Jace for CJ?
It's right in the mid lane, Monte Cristo. It's on screen now.
We've seen Jace frequently in the LCS, certainly not a bad champion by any means, but the team that we most expected to adopt it takes up that challenge against the last place team here when we thought that this really played into their strengths even in more important matches. So it's a bit weird.
And there's a lot of questions, you know, just, you know, zooming out a little bit, talking about this lineup. This is a very important series for CJ Entis just because they're in that middle of the table. They're fighting for seeding. You can't afford to look past this game. Dropping even one game, which of course two teams have already done to Spenu recently, affects their chances of pushing up towards third or second spot. So you can't afford in this champion's schedule to look past games, and maybe they've done that with three substitutes.
Yeah, maybe they have. Well, looks like Space and Max are going to want this 2v2. They do see Nuclear and Secret walking to lane and adjust their assignment based on that. That means they will get the Maokai versus Rumble matchup at the bottom side. Coco may have some issues early on against this Azir, just because that zone control, while he tries to walk up to auto attack, can be pretty good against poke-based champions. We've seen Azir kind of dominate lane against Runeglaive Ezreal, Victor, a lot of these champions that people want to play in the mid lane.
With all the sources of magic damage, Helper on the Rumble, the Gragas and the Corki all going to be doing primarily magic damage, at least till the mid game. If Coco goes off, it's going to be so hard to itemize. Only really health will be a salvation against the CJ Entis lineup.
Yeah, that's definitely true. One thing that's interesting about the Jace and the Corki, in terms of that damage itemization, is like you're saying, in the mid game, it's pretty easy just to itemize for MR, because unlike Varus and Corki, Jace and Corki don't really have the same power spikes. So
sure,
you do get more versatility in terms of your timings, because you'll be powerful for longer, but it's not that same kind of insane spike that you have, you know, around 20 minutes or 25 minutes on those two champions. So less of a risk, but the reward is lower too.
And why do you speculate that? Is that just because you have to power up the tier? Because, I mean, the itemization for a Varus and a Jace is pretty similar.
Well, it's just that now with the wave, it is, uh-oh, we may see a gank here. Trick coming in. There's the cast. Coco just going for a shot, but not going to take anything. He requires more levels now to kind of max out his abilities.
It feels like the item timings, though, you know, the armor penetration and the mana moon is the same, but I think I agree with you in that it's not the level 9 power spike. It feels like it's been pushed to what, level 11, level 12?
Indeed, I agree with you. So, Max made an early roam, not too much coming out of it, just driving Sossin back, making him a little bit more apprehensive about where he could be going. Ward placed in the topside jungle just to see if Rek'Sai is going to be coming for a gank in the mid lane. As Coco pushes up, Helper playing it safe in the bottom side. And Helper's Rumble's very interesting, because in that first game, he really misplayed some of his ultimates. But then, his second game on Rumble, he was very much on point. Great team fighting with that champion, so I'm not sure what to think about him right now. I prefer to think that it was just nerves in game one and he stabilized a little bit, but this is a big test for him.
Now look, all four games played what? Gnar and Rumble, I believe, exclusively so far as a competitive player. Those are all champions, very important, you know, team fighting oriented champions. They require split timings, so to be on champs like that, they must at least trust that he has the potential to get there.
He played one game of Maokai, I believe. But other than that, yes, those have been his primary picks.
Maokai and their skill shots.
Maokai, pretty easy.
There's a reason why when you see someone either changing role or a new top laner coming in, my first thought is just ban Maokai, because why not Maokai? If you're just new on the scene, if you have nerves, no skill shots required, targeted engage, just teleport and go.
Yeah, no teamwork required either, especially
the teleport, maybe.
Yeah, maybe, but all top laners, that could be said of. So.
True.
It's not as complex as running something like Gnar. Even though Gnar does have a lot of favorable matchups, it comes into question as to how well the individual player can manage that Gnar rage. So, yeah, I agree. The Maokai is pretty darn easy. Now, trick here at the enemy Raptors. They're still looking to gank for Coco. So I guess the plan is for CJ right now, get Coco rolling. Everyone else is on their own. Trick coming around, hiding in the fog of war. Oh, he was seen.
Oh, has to back away. The big fat frame of the Gragas.
Well, also, he was walking up while the minion wave was coming through. That's a bit of an error, actually. You have to pay attention to your own minion waves to know when those are coming in and play accordingly and make those adjustments. So he's going to have to just go and get the Scuttle Crab instead. And we haven't seen Catch really go for a bottom side gank. And considering that Trick has not been down there really at all so far, it seems like it would be a logical place to engage.
One of the things you always say about these Rumble Maokai lanes that we inevitably see at least once a night is just the penchant for pushing for both these champions. Being in position for that counter gank can reap you so many rewards if you're on a high presence jungler. And this is Rek'Sai versus Gragas. We're talking about early presence from both CJ Entis and Spen.
Yeah, and we so many times, as you're saying in this matchup, for the counter ganks, the jungle has to play in conjunction with the Rumble. That's one of the prerequisites to playing Rumble as a team, is the jungler has to know and communicate very effectively with the top laner as to when he is overextending towards the enemy turret. So the wave control is super important, because especially against a Maokai, Rumble is very, very vulnerable to getting killed. So it's unwise to be in a situation where the Gragas can't be there, especially now as Helper is pushing forward, which we are seeing Gragas head down to that side of the map. But they're going to have the information, deep ward already at the Krugs.
We're already seeing rotations from both sides. Max is left top and is now roaming towards the bottom side. The shops have come through. BF Sword, so we're expecting Corki to swap back. Neither team were able to take advantage of the vertical jungling, because of course we saw the lane swap called in the top lane, so no dragons down at 7 minutes.
Yeah, it's also so rare to see that early dragon even in a lane swap situation in Korea right now. Most teams just don't want to take that risk early on in the game, and there are very few timing windows for it, honestly. It's hard to pick that one up. So Coco going to grab his first blue buff, and we will see for Sasan do the same in a couple of minutes, barring any kind of contest from CJ Antis. Corki is nearly level 6, so he's going to be pretty happy. A little bit behind in CS, but we sort of expect to see that in the Sivir Corki lane pre-6.
The lane definitely changes. You know, pre-6, spell shielding against a Corki, it's easy as you like, of course, with the phosphorus bomb transfer time, but what movement time, but of course, once you get access to the rockets with the fairly instant damage, Trix up top, do have Equalizer available.
There it goes, Equalizer down. Soul still has his ultimate though. Here comes Rek'Sai, they're gonna have to back off of that. Really a difficult gank to make work when Maokai is that close to his turret. Soul really doesn't have to use anything at all to escape from that.
And Soul exclusively built for lane as well. He went for the Cal, not for the more greedy option of the Catalyst into the Righteous Glory for team fights. So double Dorans and Cal, not killing that tree.
Yeah, especially with a Gragas.
True.
Yeah, especially with that Gragas, that does make it quite difficult. So a little bit of relief for the Spenu bottom lane as they start to push a little bit more aggressively with the knowledge of where the enemy jungler is.
So this is the build from Sasan that's definitely coming through. We saw it from Faker 2 days ago. Keen did it in the LCS. Nashor's Tooth, okay. You know, I was kind of tunneling on the fact that the passive, of course, the on-hit damage with the AP scaling doesn't apply on the soldiers, but what it gives you in the laning phase, that high amount of attack speed and AP, really gives you a lot of early lane control. It's like an earlier power spike than you would expect from this Azir, and it feels like you don't necessarily need the mana regen of the Merlinomicon, and you get the same 20% CDR.
I think the nice thing, here we go, gank on to Helper now, catch on the top side, there's the knockup, ult is popped, they're gonna try and kill him, he will go down. Red buff will take him out, burn him, and that's going to be first blood for Spenu, and that's what we expected to see.
Yeah, it's two substitutes, of course, jungler on that top side, no defensive ward down from Trick for Helper, nothing he could do.
So, Space just gonna get knocked up there, nothing too fancy from Secret. It's a lot of mana for not really a good trade, though. You have to be careful when you use those abilities, because you don't have a lot to work with. Trick just gonna go ahead and clear out a pink ward in that bottom side. And one thing that's really nice, yeah, I was thinking about this too since we saw it, but one thing that's nice about that Nashor's Tooth is that for Azir, it gives you a lot of control over the wave. So not only do we see it against less mobile, I mean, we saw it against the Kassadin, we're seeing it against the Jace, so they can't just jump out of the Sand Soldier's range. So the more attack speed you have, the more guaranteed hits you're going to get, right? The more damage you can do in some of these trades, because they can't immediately escape it. Kassadin can't, at least pre-6. Or you just waste a whole bunch of mana. But the other part, too, is you get so much control over the speed at which you push. It's not like you just have a bunch of AP and you bomb out a wave with a normal AP mid laner. It's you have so much control over where the wave is at any given point, because you're not doing that much damage every hit, so you can stop attacking and just keep on freezing the lane or whatever you need to do.
I'll put my analyst hat on as well, Monte Cristo, and just talk about the fact that, okay, you're subbing out basically a Merlinomicon, which gives you a bit of mana regen as we go into a pause, for the Nashor's Tooth, getting the same amount of CDR. One thing that I feel that you can take advantage of if you're the enemy team, if you're CJ Entis, it's a much more blue-centric build. You need the blue buff for any semblance of mana regen, because you will not itemize for it anywhere in your build.
Yeah, And I guess the last thing is, it's surprising to us that this is coming in because it's 512, right? In 513, that item's going to be much stronger.
More ability power, 20 right. more ability power, 10% less attack speed. Definitely if you're a mage, erring towards the ability power in terms of preference.
Right. But even so, that's probably going to be even better on Azir
sure.
in the next patch. So it is a bit weird that we're seeing it pre the mass AP itemization change. Looks like we have an issue over on the CJ side of things. Looks like Max may be having some problems. And he has left the game.
Said enough. Packing up.
Said in Mad Life.
Yep. Do you think we'll ever get them, Monte Cristo, mid-game substitutes?
No.
I mean, we probably didn't expect the between series substitutes. Of course, it was Masters last year that really debuted that as an idea. I can dream. You know, I'm a soccer fan. We see plenty of substitutes.
Just take the reins. They have to reset all their hotkeys.
In the middle of, like, the flash, like, all right, Mad Life has the better WQ combo. We got this. Sub him in.
Well, Papa Smithy, if it comes to that, we're also going to be pausing for commercial breaks in the middle of games. So,
and with that, we'll go over to our Spenu ad.
Yeah, that I don't think that's going to happen. I hope it doesn't, but we shall see.
Post kill celebrations.
Oh, also something important to mention is that Spenu was actually given a warning for pausing the game for Sassen's wrist pain.
Really?
In the last match that Spenu played in. So if they have a pause like that again, they will be docked a match point.
And that is the same infraction. Actually, this is the game, the series between serial infractors, because of course, Space famously needs go to the little boys.
That's right.
So it's interesting that's an equivalent punishment, because it feels like the wrist pain, I mean, maybe it's hard to quantify.
I don't really agree with that. I think that the problem is you can't know whether a player is telling the truth about that, I guess.
Either.
But, I mean, obviously in many sports, having an injury break is perfectly okay. And if somebody's muscles are seizing up, you kind of don't have a choice but to stop. You
all right,
really
so,
keep playing through
so
it.
So work with me here, Monty. We can't have mid-game substitutes. You say a big flat no to that one. How about mid-game drink breaks?
Okay, or all bathroom right. breaks.
I don't know about the bathroom breaks. How do you explain that to the viewer? What's the way you kind of communicate that?
Yeah, I mean, really the pro team should just get catheters. That's what I think.
That's where you want it to go? Are we sticking with booths in that scenario?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. What happens below the table stays below the
table.
You just
change out all the seats for toilets.
Oh, dear.
So, looks like Space and Max getting a little bit of quality time with this tower, with the Sheen. It's always nice. Start to chip that away.
So let's learn about Nationals, too. Because, I mean, Jace is no slouch in wave clear, though he's kind of gated around, acceleration game. But the EQ combo means wave clear every 10 seconds when it comes to taking out the backline or really chunking out the melee minions. It feels like the instant pushing advantage should be squarely in Sassen's favor.
Yeah, you would think that, especially for the moment, although we do see the armor penetration starting to get pretty far up there. Looks like Coco will not be finishing his Monomune anytime soon, and there are a lot of frantic pings from Spenu as Ketch manages to get into the pit. That is a very clever tunnel, by the way, as we take a look from the pixel brush into the dragon. So if there was a ward in the river, it wouldn't have seen him. I actually don't think I've seen that before.
It's really creative pathing, to the extent that even though Jace left lane, it wasn't to even check for this dragon. They probably have an inkling now that Secret Nuclear walked over and cleared a ward. But that's an innovative and smart move by Spenu to pick up the first dragon.
Yeah, especially if I'm sure Ketch, I didn't see him use his lens right there, but I'm sure he did at one point, or they had knowledge that there wasn't any ward in there. But if you pink that brush and then use that pathing with Rek'Sai, you can really pick up something kind of cool.
So I'm going to have an analyst moment and get a bit excited about Spenu, even though, not much has happened this game. The fact that they kind of chose to get Sassen that instant wave clear option in the Nationals 2. They waited to see Coco go and pick up the blue buff, and they went and took a creative dragon. That's more levels of forethought than we've expected from Spenu in their first 12 match series, so really nice to see.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. Surprising that they would have these timings down and get kind of control that first dragon so easily. So yeah, certainly playing around the third blue buff spawn.
And that's a dragon against Rumble, Gragas, Corki, against champions who have fairly early power spikes, Rumble especially one of them. So
We're not quite there yet. I mean, Trinity Force just only now picked up, so I'm not sure that they would want to fight necessarily this early, but here comes the damage.
It's real. And where the build goes actually will be interesting to us. Of course, Manamun builds out of the pickaxe now, so he could go straight for a Last Whisper. He started off with the Longsword, which no longer builds into the Manamun. I'm still expecting the Manamun next, but flexible options for Coco.
Yeah, I also am curious where he's going. So, of course, Catch just waiting there on the side. Saucen's still with a lot of HP and mana. Catch will just make his presence known in the mid lane. Secret there.
So we're talking about 400-0 Assassin EQ combos. Okay, not a realistic thing, but that's a serious chunk of damage.
And his accuracy, too, just finding these angles around the minion wave to start playing with that poke. And Saucen immediately goes into a Seeker's Arm Guard after that. Well warranted, but Last Whisper is finished next, it may not actually have too big of an effect. He's going to take some time to actually stack that now to make sure that it's in its peak efficiency.
It is the Mana Moon that's the pickup, so we were hoping for the Last Whisper. Certainly going to be a Last Whisper soon, even though he's picked up another pickaxe on top of the Mana Moon. This poke. Do Spenu have the options to deal with the poke? Of course, they have the potential of that flank from Maokai. Kind of need turrets down to deal with that, so the laning phase itself going to be painful for Sus.
Yeah. Also, it's worth noting the farm here in the mid lane is very good for both of these mid laners. Not very many CS missed so far. Helper getting outclassed in the top side, it must be noted. Bullied out just a little bit. Going for that Liandry's early for the lane matchup up against Maokai.
Can we just tell the viewers this is 5-13 and look like geniuses, Monty? Liandry's rush going to be a massive thing on 5-13. The Jace will be interesting. The Azir with Nashor's will also be a consideration. Coco's taking a bit of damage, able to knock away Catch. I guess the one thing I'll say is that because Azir has gone for this Nashor, it's because he's basically pigeonholed himself into instant pushing. When you're an AD-based champion like Jakes, last hitting under turret should be pretty trivial.
Yeah, quite easy indeed. So Saucen here, still looking to get some damage down. Trick is waiting there, but they are seeing Max walk into that brush. Of course, they do have the ward right at the choke point around that dragon, so pink ward not going to be effective in seeing what exactly Spenu can keep track of.
What CJ want to force at this present time with the fact that Souls actually completed the Spirit Visage very early is they pretty much want a Ram Wars. They want to sit in mid and have that physical damage poke from the Jace really register with no hope of a flank because you're in that really short, you're both out of turrets up mid lane. The laning phase obviously is going to be what prevails, but no semblance of armor means that Coco's damage is going to register to all five members.
Yeah, that's if he can actually escape from this lane soon. They've got to start to make a push, and here
Saucen's
it comes.
Left the turret.
But he's back there, uses that Sand Soldier, gets chunked immediately upon returning to lane. Helper's even making a move down here. They're starting to group. Looks like they want to give up that top tower, which is already very low, and maybe force something in the mid and the bottom side. Obviously, Nuclear having some issues at the moment, matching up to the pressure from those rockets. And Saucen has to go back. And, you know, honestly, if Max and Helper, or Max and Trick, rather, can just harass this blue buff, then it's going to be a free mid lane.
Yeah,
oh, boy.
The blue buff releases free outer turret in the mid lane. We already saw the bottom is chunked and have a bit of damage as well.
Wow. I mean, that's some great play from CJ just to delay him long enough that they take the more important objective. And now, Trick's down in the bottom side, just hopping lane to lane, helping out get some damage safely.
And it's CJ Entis' time to shine. Got those early power spikes, got the poke comp, throw multiple members in a lane, and turrets will roll down.
Yeah, and as the turrets roll down, it's important that, ooh, wow, that attack speed really doing work on the turret. So Saucen going to town, he's going to get a mid lane of his own, pops the Sand Soldier on there, nicely played.
Maokai's teleporting, waiting to see that's in the bottom lane.
Max actually is going to get knocked out by Soul right there. Helper on the outside, already TPing down. Good equalizer across three. Soul getting low on the outside, and Coco just going to flash to pursue Saucen into the choke, so two for none for Spenu. Very early all-in around that dragon, but that's going to mean it goes over to CJ Andes, barring any kind of crazy steal. blue buff will be taken by them too, so CJ starting to dominate the map. And if they can get this bottom tower, they can flip Corki into the top side after the dragon, and they'll save that very low turret in top, and they can just send Helper into bottom. So these lane assignments are going to be extremely preferable to CJ Entis as soon as this tower goes down.
And the 1-2 punch we kind of talked about in Champion Select, layering down a very nice equalizer, splitting the threats for Jace to get into Hammer form and taking out the Azir. That is perfect team fighting from what is three rookies. Wait to see the replay here.
Yeah.
So the first big point, of course, is the equalizer from Helper, which, given his first game, we couldn't deny that it might have been a question mark, but look at this, really nice target selection, and they get the two closest kills.
I mean, honestly, because of all that MR, getting space within melee range of the Maokai proved actually useful because he was doing a lot of Trinity Force damage and had the Shred, too, from the Gat. So the big mistake, though, was Sol actually twisted advanced onto Janna. In that fight before getting monsooned out. So kind of a misplay. He probably just misclicked onto Corki. But that did set up an easier time to get the Janna out of lane. So it looks like they will be too late to save the top turret, though, unfortunately for CJ Entis.
Wait to see what the lane allotments are. It looks like Corki's up top, wants to push down that wave. Sivir's going to answer it as well. Maokai has the magic resist, which in the laning phase is usually preferable against this Corki, but turret damage is going to be massive. They need wave clear. They need it fast up top, Duspenu.
Yes, they do. So they're starting to send some people into the top side. Sivir will be there shortly. Four members of Spenu there already. They see it's a bit, wow, Secret has to be a little bit more careful. Getting really close to that Corki trick there to back him up in case there was any kind of funny business. So Rumble. It's getting a little bit more farm. He has been outclassed thus far, but Sol, as you were saying, has built really hard into this lane matchup and doesn't have that teamfighting Righteous Glory, so he's going to be pretty useless for a while.
Building for lane, and then this situation, what CJ wanted to do. Whenever you see someone build for lane, you rotate in another damage threat, or if you see them build exclusively for lane, you force team fights. They won the team fight around Dragon. Now they're rotating, so the 1-2 punch. Beautiful to see from CJ Entis.
Yeah, and that's the thing here. Spenu may be ahead in gold, but they are certainly not in control of this game right now. We see the buffs falling in favor of CJ. CJ is starting to really hit their stride.
Oh,
space.
Boy.
Going to get knocked up. There's the on the hunt. He's all alone, headbutted back. What can he do here? He's putting down the damage. Nuclear going to sidestep the phosphorus bomb. Space going to flash. Preyseeker hits him, and that's it. Chilling Spike.
Very strange for Space to be halfway down a lane with no turret to defend him and nobody around. Hope now from Sarsen. One EQ is half his health, and the turret damage from Jace, that certainly wasn't changed. It's massive.
Well, but the thing is, as soon as they see... Oh, Sol. Wow. As soon as they see three members committed topside, CJ already has the momentum with that push and nearly kills a tier two. So, you know, Space drawing that many people up to the top lane has been effective, but Catch coming in. There's the knockback with the Monsoon. Will save them from the Alistar. Chillings might use, but not going to be effective.
So difficult to play the Alistar against Janna. Of course, you think about just the Q, you know, the Howling Gale being an interrupt for the Headbutt Pulverize, the Monsoon. The Q was on cooldown, but the Monsoon also an interrupt. So Alistar, if you're on form as the Janna, really has few options if we're talking about linear, run at you and engage.
Yeah, absolutely. So, where's CJ going to go from here? They need to get down the remaining outers. They could push forward into the mid lane to take a tier two. Let's take a look at our tier two tower HPs around the map right now. Coco has a mountain of gold to spend. Muramana is complete. Fully stacked up. So, low. There we go. Next drink. Okie dokie. Good
not
item.
Not feeling confident enough to build towards the BF sword into the Bloodthirster just yet. Going for the Hex Drinker, just so he can get into Hammer Form, you'd have to think. If you have a Hex Drinker shield, suddenly Hammer Form is an option in teamfights.
Yeah, especially since he's probably, his job is going to be 1v1ing Sasin. If he can kind of get into that back line, Sasin doesn't stand much of a chance. He will just be exploded. So Helper now getting his revenge in the top lane. Sol has to fall back to the tier two. But at the end of that, I mean, we're still looking at an even gold game. Spenu has been doing a good job of hanging on here, and they've traded objectives every time we've seen CJ strike. They were able to take that mid turret right back with the help of that Nashor's Tooth first and the natural damage on the turrets from the Sand Soldiers.
And then we come to the oldest strategical game in the book, the poke comp versus the engage comp. As you mentioned, because they're matching the turrets coming down, there will be the potential for those flank engages from the Maokai. There will be the potential from Secret maybe to make a play like we saw a couple of days ago from Bang and get the WQ from behind. It's going to be a very execution heavy on both sides, but for now, CJ and is going to be happy with how things have played out in the first 25 minutes. You need to be at least equal in gold, but they're ahead in objectives, not even now, of course, the last objective being answered. All outer turrets on the map down.
Yeah, and Soul, he still doesn't have that Righteous Glory. When we talk about Spenu's ability to engage in 45 seconds around this next dragon, is he actually going to complete that item? Because it is crucial to get onto the back line.
Let me ask you a question. You've got about the combined cost. Is it the Righteous Glory or is it the Homeguard boots? Because he has neither.
Yeah, this is actually really bad for Spenu. I think the itemization was a bit amiss because ever since CJ had some lanes to farm deep in, we've seen Helper come back in terms of farm. He's narrowed that farm gap to about 15. So it's not that 40 lead that we had earlier in this game. So you see kind of why we don't usually see the builds go this way for a Maokai in this matchup.
I mean, the only reason that you'd rush the Spirit Physician, Righteous Glory is complete now. The only reason you rush it is you're expecting a long laning phase against the Rumble and just slightly winning trades. It's already a matchup where Maokai is expected to win by, what, 20 CS, maybe 25 CS? It's only 10 CS ahead. He's even itemized for the lane and hasn't been able to grow and cultivate that lead.
All right, Glory's done, though. He is good on that power spike, and they are going to send him into the pit, so it looks like it won't hurt him too terribly much. The question is, does he need the home guard boots too? Would that be helpful in the particular setup here? I mean, they don't have great wards for a home guard teleport.
Yeah, super, super deep wards that require a home guard to get in. I mean, Twisted Advance onto Jace is the first sentence of a one-team fight for Spenu.
Yeah, well, as long as the Jace and Janna knockback don't immediately cancel that out.
Sure.
So Helper here, he wants to play the lane. Meanwhile, Spenu somehow gets onto the dragon. Actually, CJ makes a mistake and lets them into the river. Here we go. It's like the dragon will be taken by Sibber, but kind of a strange play by CJ. You should never allow Spenu to get into the river because you need time to land that poke. If they're already on the dragon, you can't poke them out enough that it's actually meaningful.
We talked about shot calling. You have to put the shot calling around Helper, not actually walking out to the dragon, not teleporting early. Whenever we see Marin play Rumble, for example, picks up the home guard boots or at minimum, teleports to an outer turret and gets into position to put down the equalizer. Because of the execution required with that spell, need to be there early. So showing up late, burned down by Spenu, free dragon.
Yeah, you just have to maintain position. They could still get this turret, though. A lot of poke damage landing onto Spenu as Koku uses To the Skies to get over to the Wraiths, or Raptors, whatever they are. I can't keep track of all these different changes, Papa Smith.
Just don't call them popcorn chickens. That's an Atlas special right there.
Why are they popcorn?
You know, KFC, popcorn chicken.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Never want one, want a handful, all four.
Okay, there's the equalizer just to push people off. Now, Sven is going to respond with an all-in space in the front line already. And there we go. Janna goes down immediately. No Monsoon used. So that's going to be a disengage from CJ. Pretty crucial mistake. But Spenu finds the engage they were looking for. And that's a bit curious. CJ should be able to stop their first engage at the very least with all their disengage spells, but they didn't actually execute.
They have the minion pressure in both bot and top lane, so they're actually able, even as a four-man unit, with the poke from Jace and wave clear, to just stay in mid lane, not really defend or need to push back any ground. And Spenu just need to try and organize these side waves because couldn't really make any objectives pay against CJ with that pick.
Yeah, you also don't need to recall right now if you're CJ. You can actually hold that siege for a few more seconds. Maybe you get that turret. You at least get a little bit more damage. So they choose an early recall timing, actually. It's not going to help them out. Max is back now. Has that Aegis of the Legion.
From support, we don't see this too often, but yeah, used all his gold basically. In fact, you have to say, between the Chalice and the Aegis, quite a lot of gold income come through for the Janna.
Yeah, that is a bit interesting, really. Trick going for a Spirit Visage, so kind of weird itemization that we don't normally see. Catch with the more typical Cinder Hulk into Locket. And Sonya's Hourglass for Sasan, so he's going to be able to survive this J-Saul in now.
He's also going to be able to engage himself, because the moment you finish Sonya, suddenly the bigger Xeer set combos are that much safer. And I know that you kind of shake your head at that. Remember, they've got Maokai is going to go hard initiate. They already have Sivir. They're definitely an initiate comp, so at least flexibility for that kind of option for Sasan.
Yeah. I mean, why I say that is that they just don't have to. They have so many other forms of engage.
Why not all of them?
It does provide an option, but that's kind of like the last resort. Okay, so Coco getting that typical poke from behind the wall into the enemy team.
If we see Maokai go back to base, you can see there is a lane ward behind CJ Ender. So they do have the opportunity for the teleport home guard flank and the poke. I think it's time already, Monte Cristo. You cannot sit and catch poke from this team.
No, you can't. Even the Gragas barrels are going to be doing a little bit of work and just chipping you away. Looks like Sasan has his home guard boot, so he'll get back there. Righteous Glory is popped, but there is just nothing to go on. Even space, there's the equalizer going down. Doesn't really hit anybody, but it gives them the angle onto the tower. And here comes Trick, actually. Nice play onto the Sivir. Knocking her back isn't enough, though. Monsoon will cancel Secret's engage.
Such a massive play from Trick to actually get the displacement. Surprise Nuclear. Had to use all his summoners and the ultimate afterwards. That's a big take. Will they at least chunk down this mid lane turret? Looks like the answer is yes.
Yeah, they have to wait for the
minion wave.
Yeah, the wave is a little bit far off, but
Spenu needed a clear shot call. I was surprised to see Sol just standing under the turret, eating the poke. Remember, he still doesn't have a lot of armor, just now finished the Glacial Shroud. It was crying for that teleport engage and didn't get one.
No, certainly did not. And one thing I'm impressed about with Helper is a lot of more amateur rumbles will not drop the equalizer to siege a turret. They think that they have to hold on to it for a team fight, but you just want to lay it down and try and take the objective. You have to read that that's going to be the win condition of your team composition, and you can't be gun shy about using it in situations like that. So they. And it's on such a short cooldown anyway. By the time you end up sieging another tier two, it'll be back up. Nothing really to worry about.
It just stops either Sivir or Xeer from standing, you know, 500 units away from the minion wave and instant clearing it. It's punishing them for standing there. They have to kite backwards. That last 400, 500 health of the turret evaporates instantly.
Yeah. Coco going to recall now. See what his next item is. If he's going to complete that Bloodthirster, looks like that will not be it. Maw Malmortius, actually.
Man. I don't know about you, but I look at Sarsen's build, I look at Coco's build, I sense some brawling potential coming through from the item purchase they've gone for. Both of them realize, whether it's in a team fight or maybe even just in the 1v1, they're going to get in, they're going to get dirty.
Yeah.
You like a good scrap, don't you, Monty?
I love it when Coco gets dirty. With Jace, with Xeer,
oh,
I love
man.
The Coco
Those all dirty Xeer sex from Coco, my goodness. The one that he curled around the turret.
Oh, God. That's in the base.
In the base.
Yeah, I know. I'm a big fan. I'm a big fan of Bobby Smithy.
Coco, is he the highest? I believe he's got the highest kill total in the league.
He does right now. He has now actually surpassed Goon. He was tied with Goon going into this game.
Very bloodthirsty. Rest in peace, dog.
That's right, he's dead. He's never coming back.
He's dead.
Oh, the face check. Oh, dangerous. Have to use that Gale and the gate to get out. Well, Corki is soloing Dragon with a million wards around him, so he feels comfortable doing that all by his lonesome. Second Dragon for CJ Antis.
One of the things we mentioned in Champion Select, why not Varus? Because of course Varus and Jace, very similar champions. Gate's one of the big separators. You know, Jace has a little bit more mobility. Man, that poke damage is strong, but the poke damage from the Q from Varus has a very similar item ceiling. The Gate is the big difference. If you're going to go for a true poke cup, having that disengage speed is massive.
Yeah, it is. And as we can see right now, Spenu getting tricky with the Baron as the tier 2 siege goes down. It's going to be a very slow Baron.
I mean,
how much are
slow.
Are they going to have to give up actually an inhibitor for this is going to be the question. How far can CJ push? Because there's no defense on the side of Spenu. This is a big trade that they're making.
They need a Baron buff minion wave to help them.
Yeah, they're going to take it out, but oh, there it is. Baron buff minion wave will actually maybe save this tower. No, it won't. Well, that actually probably isn't a very good trade for Spenu.
Because the next time Baron comes up, they are in that horrible position of having an exposed inhibitor on the opposite side of the map. You know, you're willing to sacrifice maybe the top inhibitor turret, even then, not an ideal trade, but kind of more equivalency. Unless they can really take advantage of this Baron buff. Feels like CJ have a lot of options come 6 minutes time.
Yeah, and how are they going to take advantage of the Baron buff right now? Also, because they don't have really any minion waves except
they're gonna rush down mid.
The mid lane going in their favor. Sasan did some work clearing that out and taking it, but I'm not sure they're gonna be able to do much more than that, really. Trick may be getting a little bit greedy here, but he's got Max just to put down a pink ward and find secret. Not so secret anymore, are you? Helper. Why did he use Onyas?
Style points?
Okay.
There's rookie mistakes, and there's the casual Zonyas.
The casual Zonyas is the most bad banner. You say, I don't even need this to beat you. Go ahead.
I think the Zach Zonyas is the most bad banner for the sick pose value.
Pose value is good. Troll pull gold is also good.
Whenever it actually hurts your damage output, I'm impressed. It's kind of like when I'm playing a ranked game and I'm feeling really confident. I just flash in the base because I don't even need that flash for the first 5 minutes of the laning phase Monte Cristo. League of Legends hard mode.
I like to just flash in my opponent's face at level one. Not all in them, just flash backwards so they know I don't have flash. That's the hard mode.
You go Reginald style, Ignite level one, also very manly. There's some alpha plays you can make in League of Legends, and Helper just showed us one of the strongest.
All right, catch on the split push right now with that Rek'Sai, can get over in a jiffy. There aren't any tunnels on top side, though, so he needs to be careful about how this split push works. He will take the tier two in the end. And you know what's funny about this game is it's been really mostly dictated by CJ, but they're also 4K gold in the hole. You wouldn't know by watching, though.
It's because the things like poke really, I mean, the item timings for Jace, once he hits a certain point, kind of become irrelevant. It feels like the fifth, sixth item for a Jace isn't really going to change much of how his kit works. You can maybe throw in an Infinity Edge and get the world's luckiest W crit, but in general, hits that power trough, that power spike early. His catch will take this last out of turret. The question I was actually going to ask you, will we see an engage?
We do see an engage. Trick with the knockup, and here we go. Rumble, Equalizer cuts off Sivir in the backline. There's a knockup from Secret and Soul. He's still got his ult on. Nobody really hurt. Unbreakable Will goes down, though. Here comes the TP. Where is it? Nope. Helper. Just going to die. I thought I heard a TP.
No TPs. It was 3v3 action. Not a lot of damage with the three members. Spenu take another turret. I was going to ask you, Monte Cristo. In metas past, in years past, you would always expect a certain amount of structures and a certain amount of gold to really be considered still competitive in the game as a poke comp. Has those timings changed? It feels like Fifth Dragon isn't going to be realistic for either teams. Only two apiece at 37 minutes into the game. Has CJ's window closed, and if not, what needs to happen to make it?
Right. Let's take a look at this. I mean, Trick has a great engage here with the knockup. Sivirul popped immediately.
There's no damage.
Yeah, they try to just knock him down, but between the two forms of percent damage reduction from Maokai and Alistar, they just don't have enough to take down the front line. That is not a good sign for CJ Entis.
So answer my question then. Has the window closed for CJ, or where should they be at this one? Because it feels like a gold lead at minimum would be expected. There's 6,000 gold behind.
Yeah, and I think we can see right now that maybe that fall off is happening actively. Not even a thorn mail yet from Soul, but that's also going to be a pretty dangerous item. So Spenu really hanging in this one quite well.
Well, from no armor at what, 17, 15 minutes in the game, 20 minutes later, frozen heart and the makings of a thorn mail with that chain vest, and Aranduin's completed by the Rek'Sai as well. Suddenly, and we saw it in that 3v3, Coco's not really shredding down members anymore.
No, he's not. So the question now for CJ is, can they play to get a pick, really? It's going to be hard to find the right person, though, to find the pick onto, because Alistar and Maokai are not really feasible.
And the risk of the pick is the burst damage is coming from Jace. If it's flashed away from, because of course you can flash away from the two of the sky's Q damage, or if it's turned around, it's going to be a problem. Speaking of a turnaround.
And here's Trick. He gets knocked up. He's all by himself. And now Soul finds his way onto the back line. They lock down Max. Can they finish it up? No. Soul just going to get out of there. Sasan very low after the equalizer in that bottleneck. Now we see a possible turnaround right here as they keep on walking up towards that minion wave. CJ going to exit stage left here into the river.
He is very low, so he cannot really be in range, even though he's one of the primary damage threats. Feels like Dragon is the safest call, and with a minute 40 to Baron, Spenu should pick up their third Dragon. Movement speed for the engage comp, that's an important thing.
That is an important thing, and there's no real retaliation here. Coco is going to go on a secret mission into the top side, try and take down this turret, push this wave forward, but that's about all they could do. And that gold may not be that useful to them at this stage. Ghostblade done for Coco. It's like a stack in the black coming for Spenu. Are they going to choose to engage on this? CJ should have to leave immediately. They should be very scared of what can happen to them.
Yeah, a lot of wave play coming through from the Sivir. Zeus coming, doesn't have home guard boots. No, he does have home guard boots. He'll be there very, very soon. Baron control, that's going to be the big question. Let's talk about the Baron buff. It feels like Spenu got a lot, but it wasn't necessarily off the back of the Baron buff. Next Baron buff, probably a preview for who will be winning this game.
Yeah, CJ has to get a good position on that to get the poke down early. And up. Coco getting caught out, that is huge! And he has the Hexdrinker up, but it's not going to be enough. Soul is able to escape from that all-in, and now Trick will fall in the back line. Flash forward from Nuclear, he gets a crit, takes down the Janna for the double. Sossin still chasing, can Sossin go through with this? He's not committing with his E quite yet. Shield up onto Sossin, but they are not going to push this any further. Smart move right there. Just go ahead. You have enough tankiness to take that Baron. Kachin Soul will go back. Actually, I'm surprised Soul is going back. They could definitely just tank the Baron right now. Catch will be there in a jiffy with that Void Rush.
Are there any item timings that justify it? No, Sossin can't complete his death cap. Very strange recall. We've seen games punished for less, Monte Cristo. Strange.
They 100%, with the equalizer down, should have gone for that Baron without recalling.
It's Bloodthirst and Nuclear.
I mean, Catch can recall. He's got Void Rush, but everybody else, there's no excuse. So this is confusing, but it doesn't look like it's going to get punished.
There's no way for CJ, even with some wards around the area, to contest second Baron buff for Spenu. The first one was a very smart, sneaky one that really kept them in the game. We thought the base breaking and bottom might be relevant, but multiple team fight and skirmish wins in a row to Spenu, and suddenly 10,000 gold ahead.
Yeah, and you see the team fracture right here. The two carries going into the river alone. With this level of engage, you really can't stand to be a part of if you're running that poke composition.
The wait for the flash over and auto attack, canceled auto attack, 600 crit into 630 crit, and rest in peace, Janna.
Nobody's gonna survive that one. GA onto Nuclear, very interesting. It's actually a good pickup in this particular situation in case Jace manages to find her all by her lonesome. So this is looking bad for CJ, but Spenu, I mean, all credit to them. They showed up this game. They had some clever Dragon and Baron kills, and they managed to get into a six-item phase where they have multiple GAs. Of course, we see one onto Soul, too. I guess he just doesn't even care about getting a Thornmail this game, interestingly enough.
And although it felt like at every point CJ were hitting their timings, they were always behind in gold this game. The team with Rumble Jace that was smashing down turrets was behind in gold to a balanced teamfight engage comp from Spenu. And now you're at the point where it's late enough in the game and the gold lead is such that doesn't feel like CJ really have any options barring the pick of all picks onto one of these primary targets.
Yeah, this is going to have to be a pretty epic comeback for CJ Antis, but I mean, Spenu actually starting to get much, much better in this second round robin.
It's exciting, you know, at one point, you know, four or five series in, Spenu game's almost an eye roll. You're like, oh goodness, this team again just going to lose 2-0. Suddenly, really competitive against multiple teams. Took a game off KT in prime condition to take a game off CJ, and there's no Runeglaive of Ezreal asterisk this time.
There is the sub asterisk, though.
That's true.
Trick tries to go in, but there will be the Zhonyas from Sossin, so they don't actually pick up a kill. They tried to punish Spenu's multi-lane push.
Multi-pronged attack.
Multi-pronged attack. Well, they get him low enough that Spenu starts to get nervous and heads out without actually cracking the base. So CJ clinging tenaciously to life, but that is probably not going to be the case for much longer. I mean, they can't even kill this Maokai once, let alone twice with a GA.
Man, two GAs on the lineup when they don't really have the attack speed modifiers, because remember, this is Corki, Jace. Neither of them are going to build a lot of attack speed items. Only the Blade of the Ruin King for attack speed, and the tiny fraction that comes through from the Trinity Force. It's not the attack damage, attack speed, critical strike triumvirate for breaking down tanks. Soul is going to be immortal, and then he'll come back.
Yes.
Well,
what's the point of coming back if you're never going to die the first time?
These are very deep philosophical questions that you're asking right now about this movie.
I don't think much philosophy is going to be required from this Spenu line. The moment they locked in the Zhonyas, the moment Sivir picked up a GA, it's all about the hard engage. They're smashing heads in. They're not sitting back and philosophizing.
Well, they can just dive now, too, which is the scary part. So Spenu, I actually think...
But will they dive?
Yeah,
because you never know with these teams. I remember you saying dive, dive, dive during one of those seven-hour casts you had with Doa this week. Diving's never a guarantee.
Well,
unless it's Anarchy.
It is a guarantee that you will win the game by diving, especially if you have all the waves controlled. I mean, you take this dragon and then you just go dive them, because there is no penalty to losing out on a dive. That bot lane turret is so low right now. You take dragon, you hit the bot lane, and because everything is pushed up, there's no risk. You die, okay, well, it takes a minute for you to get back up. What exactly is CJ going to do? They can't take a dragon, they can't take a baron. They can't take any your base turrets, more than likely, if they don't have waves, so...
But on a human level, you can understand, all right, we'll take the fourth dragon in a couple of seconds, we'll have four dragons, fifth dragon win condition. This is a team that hasn't done a lot of winning. On a human level, you can understand, all right, play it safe, no dive. The issue is, you look at item builds, for example, Helper, 0-2-2, got a bit of CS, but has three items only. If you wait for these timings and he picks up a fourth, a fifth item and you lose the fight, that's your own mistake. That was the opportunity cost you opted into by not going for the aggressive plays. So it's certainly punishable.
Exactly. Spenu is as powerful as they're going to get. They are six items across the board right now, and CJ can only catch up in terms of itemization at this juncture.
And Soul and Catch, just press your CC, flash on top of the Jace. You both have Thornmail for one of them, a huge stack of armor for Soul, Righteous Glory. Cancel out that Jace, only really magic damage after that. Feels like the synergy, this feels like the strategy. Of course, the armor does the double duty and reduces the turret damage as well. But you can never guarantee with these newer teams whether they're assertive enough to go for that dive.
I think they're going to wait for the next Baron, Papa.
Are they going to wait for the fifth dragon as well? All of the buffs.
They won't have them at all at the same time.
There'll be an overlap, maybe. No, they won't, actually. It would just expire.
Yep.
Which is more important to them, if I was to ask you? Is it the Baron buff or is it the Dragon buff? If you had to choose one.
Dragon.
The Baron buff gives them the minions, does help a little bit against the instant wave clear of Jace and Corki, because of course they want to poke with burst damage, magic, and physical respectively. But yeah, I mean, the true damage and the doubling of stats.
Yeah, the true damage and the doubling of stats, and it's especially the doubling of the tower damage, too, because if you're going to dive, your AD carry can use just a couple of auto attacks to take down the turret.
And it feels like the patch notes have been reversed a few times, and Sarsen can just plop his W on top of the turret and instant explode it like it used to with the old AP ratios.
Okay, well, Baron up in a minute. Spenu.
So six items. Nuclear is really six items.
Yes.
Really, really six items.
Backed out. No boots for him.
Need some captain's boots from someone else. That'd be helpful.
Especially on the Alistair, actually. But Alistair.
Maokai?
Oh, Maokai would work. But they, well, I don't know about that. I'd rather have him on Alistair. Distortion enchantment just isn't as useful on Alistair.
There's
sure.
been no flash WQs this game. I don't remember one.
I don't remember one either.
Certainly not Wolf's MVP holy cow performance.
But you want the home guard for the flank on Maokai.
That's fair. So let's just twiddle our thumbs, because unfortunately Spenu just... They're not there, Monty. They're not there in that development. We've seen a lot of things, but we haven't seen the dive.
Well, there's the Righteous Glory knock up. There's a Boomerang Blade into Max. Max already at 50% HP. Catch comes in from the flank. He will get the knock up. Chilling Smite down onto Max. There's a nice equalizer into the back line. But Sasin just going to go in. He kills Max right away. Sasin goes down. And Space and Coco doing some work, but they're in the center of four tanks right now. Nuclear still starting to attack. And Helper just gets bounced around before his Zhonya Soul on the outside zoning. Nuclear takes the last hit with an auto. And that looks like... It'll be a Baron.
And that poke just does nothing from Coco. He's almost a non-factor in these fights. I think, honestly, you switch up your build, get an Infinity Edge there, because unless you get lucky with some crit, you're just doing no damage whatsoever to either Soul or Catch if you're Coco.
Yeah, that is, it's a big question mark here. I trade out the Ghost Blade for the Infinity Edge.
Sure.
But we don't know if he has that much money. Probably doesn't. So Nuclear going to start this. This is going to be the desperation attempt. All three members of CJ are full HP. Nuclear going to eat a Shock Blast, and CJ actually going to scare them off.
Now, the Baron's actually not released that much. It was hitting at about 10,000 health, up to 7,000.
Yeah, they don't have a smite, though, so they can't. Oh, they do have a smite with Trick. But they're not going to go for it. Don't want to pick up that objective. Oh, man. If they recall, Soul does not have his teleport.
All right, Soul was smart. He canceled his recall, but CJ have a lot of damage on these members. Jace does a lot of damage to either neutrals or turrets. Falling low, 6,000 health.
All right, Trick just going to re-engage. There's the Randuin's active. Coco gets caught. Nuclear with the flank ult, and that'll be it for Jace. Now they're going to go back in. Soul gets a nice knock-up on three members, and Nuclear just charging through right now. He's going to get a ton of auto attacks. Another Twisted Advance. Goodbye, says the crit. And here we go, Trick getting low, double kill, finished off by Nuclear. Now, will they push four men down? Long timers.
Wow, okay.
Sasin actually moving up the mid lane, but they have not tended to this enormous minion wave in bottom side.
Come on, Spenna, this is the time to be assertive. You couldn't pull off the turret die, but with 60 seconds death timers, surely you can win the game.
Yeah, they should be able to help her with no TP to try and move that minion wave forward.
A million armor on Soul.
Yes.
He might die
amount.
Once.
And here he comes. He's back from the grave. Whoop. Literally.
So was Helper for a second there. Dead again. And Spenu, okay, couldn't do the assertive turret diving, but still won the game.
Yeah, that was another win for Spenu. They've won at least one game in their last three best of threes. Yes, it was against three subs. Don't think we're going to be seeing three subs from CJ in game number two here. But still, you have to credit Spenu for trading objectives, not really ever falling behind in terms of gold, and cleanly playing those team fights at the very least. Was their sense of how far they were ahead to close out the game very good? Not really, but their team fighting was actually pretty solid.
And against a mid-game comp, remember, Jace, Gragas, Rumble, Corki, even when they hit their power spikes, always keeping themselves at least 2,000 to 3,000 gold ahead, growing it to 10,000 eventually. That takes a lot of doing. That's really solid play against a strong poke comp. CJ enters Pokemon. We wondered when we see the Jace. Okay, it's with the subs, but certainly not successful this time.
No, it was not. Looked impressed. Too many concerns about a specific power spike in that game. So,
speaking of research, Spenu now finally able to use their research because picks and bans would not have been centered around three subs. The Shen we talked about, it's going to be a top lane Shen if it was going to be one. Banned away against Shy.
Yeah, support Shen. Not really a Korean pick at this stage of the game.
Red, white, and blue only.
Yeah, I don't think it ever will be a Korean pick, but who knows?
Someone will flex it. Anarchy will flex it. Come on.
All right, all right. We'll just say it won't be used probably by the top teams, but you never know what you're going to see. I mean, not even that many teams using Shen in the top lane comparatively to LCS teams, that's for sure.
Kalista banned away, kind of expected ban even against Nuclear. But again, an MVP performance. Don't give him a champion who, at least on patch 5.12, and of course today the last two series we're expecting on 5.12, probably going to move into 5.13 next week. People really debating about the power of Kalista after changes. Our Bard ban comes through. Now Madlife hasn't lost on Bard, but that's a strange ban.
He also has not been playing it recently.
No, it's about three or four series behind. I believe he's 2-0 on the champion, but curious ban.
Yeah, very curious.
What do they know that we don't?
Yeah, exactly. Because just Madlife, well, he was fine. I would say he was pretty good on the bar. Wasn't extraordinary, but
I've worked it out, Monty. Sorry to cut you off, but I've worked it out. What they did was they sorted the wins from this team by KDA. 32.5 KDA Shen, banned away. 22 KDA Bard, banned away. So, you know, they just control F, they loaded up the Excel spreadsheet, and these are the bans they got.
I guess that must be it. The KDA bans. We'll see if you're theory holds true with the third ban here. Yeah, it's been up. I mean, we haven't seen bans against Madlife Smart for a while either, so that's not really a factor. They're going to ban Annie instead.
So suddenly, you have to think, backline threat bans mostly across the board from Spenu. Are they looking to run a more immobile mid laner?
Good question, but there's still Alistair available. So if they don't pick Alistair here, they're still dealing with that backline threat champion.
From the support role especially, a lot of respect coming out to Malph. Not the Thresh, so the question mark always on the Thresh. Will it have to be taken away? Because not many teams just hand over Thresh on a silver platter to Malph.
Well, you'd think they would take the Alistair here as a result of their, like you said, backline threat bans to this point. And then what is their plan for Sasan in this rather curious setup that they have seen? So it will be the Alistair. So it's starting to come together for Spenu.
So many insane champions available. When the likes of Bard and Annie are eating up bans, a lot can sleep through the pick ban phase. Ryze notably coming through and prioritizing the Ryze, the Alistair over the Ryze. I don't know about that one.
I would be very excited to see Shy on Ryze. Obviously, the CJ teams were the first teams to really ever play top lane Ryze in a competitive setting.
Who was it? Was it Shy or was it Flame?
They both did it like at the same time,
yeah.
Basically. So it was very close to each other. I don't recall which one was first because it all happened simultaneously,
yep.
Effectively. But you could tell it was definitely something coming out of the CJ gaming house. And it would be fun to see him on that champion again. Of course, we have seen mid lane Ryze to a fair degree.
Definitely looms as a bit of a flex pick.
They're going to give it up.
Coco's on the Azir, but Ryze has now skipped past the first two rounds of picks. What crazy days we live in, Monte Cristo.
Where the Azir is the priority, of course. Makes sense for CJ, though. Coco has been very stable on that champion.
And their answering pick to Azir didn't really work out. Of course, they went with the Jace last game, couldn't make it done. It's still a pick away from Sasan, so we're still hoping, we're still praying. They banned the backline threat. Is it Velko's time?
That's a question.
The dream. There it is.
He's
flash it.
He's 0-2 on Vel'Koz so far. It actually hasn't worked as well as they might have liked. I mean, even Samsung, Crown was able to stop it in a way that Faker couldn't in that matchup in the mid lane. And I think the Victor still going to have a hard time against the Azir. Meanwhile, the Vel'Koz has been doing pretty well in lane against Azir, actually. But it will be the Victor in the end. I think that is definitely the safer, more meta decision, and it will be Ryze. So the Ryze gets through. Sol has actually had a pretty good game on Ryze in the past. What are they going to play in the top lane as a possible counter to this? Will be, they're going for the Kog'Maw here. They have the Azir ultimate for Peel already, and Shy mostly just playing utility and tanks at the top lane. If he doesn't take Rumble, that is.
Yeah, and the Rumble, of course, has been his most played champion. 5-2 coming into this series, of course, not including Helper's games. CJ Entus wins. That looms as the most obvious pick. We'll just have to wait and see, because if they go for the Kog'Maw, things might change. Are they going to be pressured enough to actually pick their AD carry over the support? Because we know Thresh is available. Kog'Maw's done a lot of winning, actually the highest win rate champion in all of champions so far. One mid lane pick included, but AD carry Kog'Maw in general, 72% Kog'Maw win rate, just a percent higher than TF, but highest win rate overall.
Yeah, their problem, even though he has been on the winning end of things, most of the time we see him paired with more Peel. Certainly the Azir Kog'Maw combo, very popular for its great Siege, Poke, and Kog'Maw protection at the moment. But that said, the Rumble is going to have to buy some sort of Zhonya's Hourglass to actually serve as a frontline. And for support, you would think it'd be Thresh or Janna just for the backline peel.
I mean, look, Azir, wonderful peeling for a champion. Okay, not really Rumble's primary job, but you look down Spenu's side, I mean, Ryze and Victor are going to have a lot of trouble getting onto the Kog'Maw in terms of dealing damage to them, so I actually don't mind it. It feels like a fairly low-risk Kog'Maw, maybe not the lowest of risks, but if Nuclear actually opts into what has emerged as a counter-laning matchup, this is the Kog'Maw versus Corki. The five times that we've seen him recently, it's always been against the Corki, and Kog'Maw's been winning it each time.
Yeah, that is true, but now they have the Corki pick, but they also take the Jarvan. Now, Ketch has been playing a lot of Jarvan. He is the Jarvan jungler of this league here in Korea, and so he takes a lot of those picks, tries to get them to work. It has been somewhat successful. They nearly beat SKT in a game with the help of that Jarvan, and they just want to lock down the Kog'Maw in the back line. That's it. They have that all-in potential, and you need that heavy engage when you have to have this Ryze and Victor catch up. All in all, despite the heavy magic damage, I really like Spenu's composition.
And the Jarvan fits the meta, because of course it's a poke meta, so of course a really hard engage like Jarvan is a high priority. It's just, it's a hard champion to get through the laning phase. Unless there's a lane swap, you can actually be at significant risk of both being invaded, and you fail a gank, and his base stats are so brittle at this point. Okay, instant CC from Ryze, very obvious gank target, the Ryze lane, but otherwise, could be a struggle, especially if Ambition really gets on top of the job.
Yeah, and Ambition and Madlife have been struggling recently to actually get their ward synergy together when it comes to getting deep wards in, clearing wards, and they haven't really been on the same page. So they could get caught out during that. We've seen that happen multiple times already. So CJ Entis needs to play a little bit better in this game, clearly, to get into the late game in a bit more of an easy situation. Spenu, heavy on that magic damage, but still very threatening with late game burst.
It's a tricky comp to run from CJ though, Monte Cristo, because there's no engage. There's no engage whatsoever. It feels like if they don't get the control of this game, whether it's a big lead in terms of gold, a turret lead, or maybe even just the positioning advantage around Dragon, CJ cannot make things happen unless they dictate the pace of this game.
Yeah, two engaged champions from Spenu too, so they will be able to close the gap with Victor and Ryze. Not too much of a worry there. Would have rather seen a Sivir, but you know, the Corki'll do. So we'll see how this game goes. We are loading up right now to get into game two. Will this actually be a 2-0 victory for Spenu? They have to get some scaling done, but they may be able to make it work. Let's get into the game. Cheering for Madlife there.
The specific chance. That's a different one. That's a curveball for me, Monte Cristo.
Yeah, they said Hongmingi, which is Madlife's name. So very interesting that we have those chants coming in today.
From a place of love.
From a place of love, of course. So, all right. Sasen sees the ward in the mid lane. No big surprise. And Sand Soldier in the brush. Well, Spenu, I am actually very afraid of this composition coming from them if I were CJ Entis, because if they can go into the late game even, this actually isn't a very difficult composition to operate. Basically, you Jarvan ult somebody, Ryze presses R, runs forward, and just face rolls on the keyboard to get some damage down. Same thing with Victor.
I understand to an extent, but sometimes the Cataclysm can actually have some negative synergy with Ryze wanting to get in range of the Rune Prism, because of course the immovable terrain, okay, maybe you have to even flash to get into that Cataclysm themselves, so it can work, but there can potentially be weird range issues between the two.
Well, even that considered, Sasin will be able to Gravity Well and Chaos Storm inside.
He even has the Ghost to come help.
Yeah, Cataclysm, so I think I'd be pretty confident about Spenu getting a good engage one way or another here. They will get the damage down. And CJ also picking a... They have a bit of more of a smoother curve, obviously, but it's not like they have good tools to stop the Ryze. I mean, Rumble here, kind of whatever when it comes to dealing with the Ryze in lane. And there's a lot of kill pressure from Ryze Jarvan. Not hard to miss that flag and drag if there's a Rune Prison onto Shy. So it's going to be an interesting one. CJ really can't have that same level of play, but unlikely that they will now with their starters in.
And the Ryze versus Rumble matchup's a really interesting one to me because, you know, meta's passed a year ago. This was a very common lane matchup, and it was a counter lane matchup for Rumble. Rumble could burn down the Ryze with the low base stats, hit a couple of harpoons and kill him. But because of the range changes, because of the fact that Sol now has 700 range on his Q, he can actually harass from further away. The ranges do help out the Ryze, and it's such a wonderful lane for the Jarvan to gank that it feels like this lane's tipping more towards Ryze. So you look down CJ's comp, if they're not running winning lanes, they don't have engage in the late game, it's basically execution to a fault. If you don't get on top of those objectives in the mid game, how will you ever make anything happen?
Yeah, that is quite problematic. Their setup has to be better. And of course, we always say this with a caveat, there were subs playing, but one of the things that they didn't do in the last game was stack Dragons very well. Nice hook onto Nuclear. That's going to be some good trading there
secret. Hears the roar from the crowd and say, all right, I'll WQ. You know, I can hit my stuff too.
Yeah, but it's just not as effective there, right? Just a very defensive use. Fortunately, they have sustain. But one of the problems in the last game was they were allowing Spenu to get into the river with the poke, and they were getting onto the dragon first. CJ cannot let Spenu get onto the dragon first.
Catch falling so low in the jungle.
Well, that's what happens. Yeah, you can't let him get onto the dragon first. Otherwise, you kite back out. There's no reason to really kite. So the early ward there, courtesy of Soul, will find a quick gank. Not going to be very effective from Ambition.
If there's ever a time where this laning phase is good for Poki, it's the really early levels. So that actually amplifies the importance of getting that huge trade from MadLife hitting the Death Sends early in the laning phase. Once you get to this, you know, 4 or 5 points in the Biocane Barrage, Corki, even with his long range presence, Ambition taking a really nice path.
Yeah, coming in from behind. Soul is there. Soul is just getting hit by the harpoon. Soul has to flash, but he's still going to die. Flash forward by Shy on the overheat, secures the kill. And that rise, not a lot of stats for that early on, and he's going to pay for it.
It was really greedy, I think. He took extra ticks of the flames than he needed to, and by the time he flashed, it was trivial to flash after him. Needed to be more just quick on the flash.
Yeah, I think he thought he was just close enough to his turret that it wasn't going to matter, but that was not the case. And first blood for this Rumble is huge here because he will be able to start to itemize efficiently, probably going for an Abyssal, perhaps some early Merc Treads, depending. We do see that a lot in Ryze matchups. Obviously not the greatest if you're Rumble, but sometimes just necessary.
See the Death Sentence hit under Secret, so MadLife's Thresh mechanics predictably on point in the bottom lane.
Well, I wouldn't have said that a year ago, though.
True.
MadLife certainly has gotten his mechanics back on point after a bit of a slump. See MadLife's all-time Thresh record at nearly 60% here in Korea. Of course, it'll be more if you include some international competition.
Jarvan, we already saw when we saw him almost die to red buff. Very brittle in the jungle, so we usually expect him to make a big impact around the lanes. Doesn't really want to be farming his jungle. Level 4 now, hasn't found pathing around to the top lane, despite the fact that only now is Shy putting down a defensive wall.
Yeah, a little bit late. He was pushed up to on that gank that we saw Ambition execute, but there wasn't any play around it. Just not playing very well around the rise quite yet. While Sossin, of course, predictably having a bit of trouble with the Azir in lane, has to go back early, will maybe lose a couple CS off of this, but most importantly, just give Coco that control over the lane.
And the laning phase for a Victor, before that 1,000 gold investment, we see Soul actually trying to check the bush. Ambition's here as well. He's not expecting Rumble in the brush. He may pay for this.
Yep, Equalizer coming down. There's the tunnel under the wall. Rune Prison onto Shy, but they can't dive this. Smart play just to back off.
And honestly, not the best Equalizer.
Also late from Ambition to actually follow up on it. So a little bit of miscommunication between Shy and Ambition.
You know, once you get that Aftershock, the E augment, so much faster to clear these waves. Even if Coco opts into what is the now popular Gnashor's Tooth build, you cannot match Sarsen's instant wave clear onto the back line from level 7 onwards with the Aftershock Death Ray.
Yeah, I'm wondering if we are going to see that build one more time.
Double Doran, so he's gone for a lot of early game. It's a risk. I feel like if you finish it slowly, you're really punished compared to the going for the Merlinomicon, for example. And of course, we mentioned, you lose control of your blue buff, mana problems are plowed.
Yeah, but that's the thing, is at least two Doran's rings makes up for a little bit of the mana regen that you lack if you go straight into the Gnashor's Tooth. So I think there's that aspect of it too. And it's not that much of a delay, really. So may just be preferable to make him less blue reliant, even though it will delay that first completed item. But we'll see if he even goes for it. I mean, we don't have any evidence to that point quite yet.
There's always two schools of thought on items like this. For example, you could say, all right, if you already have a champion that struggles to wave clear, get the Gnashor's Tooth, instant push him and start to chip down turrets. But against a champion like the Victor in this situation, maybe you just buy it, just try and match the wave clear. So there's always arguments to and forward, but it's interesting to see it come through. It's, again, not necessarily the most gold efficient item because you're not taking use of the passive very much, but still very effective in a lot of laning matchups.
True, true enough. Right, so tiered up for Ryze now. Shy with the, actually going for the Haunting guys. He is feeling very confident in this lane. We normally don't see that in the Ryze Rumble matchups. Magic Resist is usually the name of the game. So if he gets ganked, that may come back to bite him. But Ambition, always with that presence in the jungle on the Rek'Sai, has that Void Rush to the top side. And, you know, Catch has really just been out of sight this game. And whoa, the damage.
One more ultimate will be enough. It'll use all of his mana bar. No, of course, he's healed through now, so Living Artillery is not in kill range. This is what we said. Remember, Nuclear opted into what we know is a bad laning matchup for Corki.
Yeah, it certainly is. Living Artillery not going to hit Nuclear that time. And fortunately, he has the Alistar sustain, so he is getting back up in terms of HP with the help of those potions. So only a very narrow window, like you're saying, for the actual kill.
It's not like this laning matchup's going to get any better for the Corki. Of course, with Trinity Force, you have some all-in options, but Poke Advantage is always going to be there for the Kog'Maw with the extra range on both the auto attacks and the Living Artillery. So Nuclear expecting some jungle pathing and jungle ganking from Catch, whether it was top or bot, we're not seeing either.
All right, so yeah, Ambition really the only one ganking top. Catch just hasn't been there. Finally, they ward the Tribe Rush to make sure that Soul will be aware of any dives before they occur. It's going to perhaps prompt Catch to do something, but I mean, this guy, he's been farming, but he's even behind it. Oh, there we go, flash pulled. After the equalizer drops, they're gonna be happy enough, just putting damage onto the turret, it would seem. Wow, Soul coming back under the tower. They're just gonna flash onto immediately. Chilling Smite down already. Rune Prison coming, Ambition is going to fall. Is Shy gonna go down too? No, he has his flash, but he's gotta get out. Catch on the way into the top lane. And they had good wards for that, actually. One in the river and one right by the wolves. So a very safe dive. Space. Actually gonna get the kill there, but Secret will finish off the enemy AD carry, and he's gonna farm Evenwell Death.
With the kill trade, definitely in the advantage of Space. He's the one that picks up the kill credit rather than the support and Secret picking up. He's gonna try and hold the wave, so at least some CS available to Nuclear, but only caught the tail end. Have to think some skill shots involved in that particular one.
Yeah, and the top lane dive, bit interesting that they tried it again. They tried to surprise him with that flash on Burrow when it looked like Ambition was just leaving, so it didn't catch Soul too off guard, and trading one for one is kind of good for him right now, actually. It depends on how hard they continue to focus that lane. Resetting his gold total may actually be something they don't want in the end, but we will find out. Space actually just refuses to take the Lantern. Instead pops his heal, and then Secret held off by the hook just for a moment before the Unbreakable is popped. So pretty standard trade there, I'd say. Interesting that he didn't go for the Lantern, but the headbutt was still up, so.
Yeah, the lane position looked a bit weird. Maybe it's because the Lantern was down, but the fact that Space was so far to the top of the lane, a bit strange in how that actually came to be. As Catch finally in lane, hits it onto Shy. Rune Prison's abound, you'd have to expect.
Yeah, there's the Rune Prison. Cataclysm for that burst of damage. Another kill for Soul. CJ going to respond, of course, with a dragon on the opposite side. Nothing from Sasset. He has to be bottled up next to his turret to farm at the moment. So this is going to be first dragon of the game over to CJ. Entis has that response. Catch just staying in the top side to get some damage down onto the tower, but Soul running very low on mana.
And does he actually want to break this turret? Does he actually want to end the laning phase in top? Because Ryze is still going to be powering up for a large majority of this game. No, he's not putting priority in it. Shy with the home guard.
He's coming back. He wants revenge. He does not have really much damage, though. Is he actually going to go for it? There's no mana, Shy. Just do it. Oh, man. I think he could have gotten that kill and gotten out.
We were talking about alpha male players last game. He had the right mindset, but he chickened out.
He did. There was no mana on that Ryze. There was not going to be sufficient follow-up. He had the damage to pull it off. Now Merc Tread's done for Shy, so he's changed his mind.
He put a lot of gold into the boots now with the home guard enchant as well. 1675 gold spent on boots, and the first teleport, suddenly a teleport window open for Ryze. Nope, he closes it by just opting into going for the farm.
Yeah, he needs that farm. He did fall behind, even though he has evened out when it comes to kills with Shy. Man, I really think Shy should have gone for that.
I do too. I mean, you could see that he would have taken, what, three and a half more turret hits before he would have died. Not really sure what was going through his mind. Maybe he just wasn't able to really judge the mana bar.
Maybe he thought the catch was still there. That's another possibility.
The only thing I can think of, Monte Cristo, is that maybe he didn't know how much mana was required for the one rune prison, and the stun would have been two and a half, three turret hits more, and maybe that would have been enough. That's the only credit I can really give to Shy in that case.
Yeah. It was definitely close, because he does have a lot of mana after starting to stack that tier, and when he already had the Sapphire Crystal.
Against tier champions, the mana bar, at least from a visual glance, is quite misleading.
Yes. Yes, it is. It's not segmented like the HP bar, so you can't do a quick count. That is actually...
Should we nerf mana-based champions like that? Segment their mana bar?
I think you should, honestly. Why not?
Good question.
What's the problem with doing that?
Right, it's all about making things transparent and giving us more information. Feels like it might have actually got Shy a kill.
Yep. So, Raptor just being contested by the likes of Sasin and Coco and Catch right now, and it will be taken by Catch with the smite. So, not too exciting.
Nope. Early game from both these games, not very exciting.
It's not that bad. We have 6 kills in 14 minutes. That's actually high for a Korean game, really.
I like how you had to preface that. Of course, I do have my Chinese links. Where's the 14 kills, Monte Cristo?
Yes. Thank God you have time to think in these games. Just dial it back. Take a relax. Take a nice leisurely analysis of what's appearing before you.
Yep. Not much, really. Just a bit of farming. Soul. It's probably actually quite... It's one of those rare occasions where not taking a turret actually feels pretty good for the top laner, because he wants that Rod of Ages. He wants to start stacking. That's when he wants the laning phase to end, is when he actually has, you know, 5-6 stacks in the Rod of Ages.
Indeed. Well, Coco has been slowly doing work, chipping out the mid lane turret.
We didn't mention it, but no Nashor's Tooth. Coco not a believer in that build. Gone for the Merlin Omicron, so the old meta meeting the new.
Well, I don't know if that actually would have been as good of a buy against Victor, but it seems like if it works against Jace, it would work against Victor. But
how about we try and be, you know, put our analyst hats on. Let's say against instant line wave clear, the likes of, say, Twisted Fate or Victor, maybe not the Nashor's Tooth.
I don't know, because you also wave clear pretty fast with a QE combo from Jace, and you don't need to stand there to do it or walk up to do it, really, so.
That's fair. Well, whatever reason, Coco not believing the Nashor's Tooth, just the Merlin Omicron, so the upside of that being that if Blue was ever contested, at least he has a bit of mana regen right out.
Yeah, certainly more conservative approach.
Yep.
But I think CJ just opting for a conservative style to this game. They need to have faith that they are the more veteran team, that they can. If they play defensively enough, they can just wait out a mistake from Spenu. And so far, that mentality actually has given them a bit of a gold lead. Uh-oh, Shy is forced to flash through the Cataclysm.
Good trading of cooldowns, of course. Much shorter cooldown for the Cataclysm than for Shy's flash. Ambition sniffing around bottom lane. How do you feel about this buy from Sasin? Actually bought a really fast home guard to try and keep up that turret, as far as I can tell. Every time he goes for an item now, at least, he'll be able to power through to mid and stop Azir from smashing down the turret.
I think he's just really worried about Azir taking the turret, like you said, because it's already gotten so low in these trades that if that is opened up right now, that is absolutely huge for CJ, because they already have that first dragon. It's early in the game. Maybe they go for 4 or 5 right now. So I understand him having that priority. Shy actually maybe sacrificed his tower for that not delayed recall. 40 HP, very close. Not sure that was worth it.
Quite a big buy, though. Of course, Soul picks up the Rod of Ages. Now we're looking at 27 and a half minutes.
Ooh, that is pretty late, actually, all things considered. Normally, you'd want to see that. It's surprising it is so late, because we have... Actually, the 2 kills onto the rise, it's just mostly that farm. Ooh. Catch taking a bunch of damage. That Trinity Force Kog'Maw can hurt.
And what a timing as well. 7 seconds before Dragon spawns. Now Spenu going to be woefully out of position if CJ do decide to try it now. They do have the teleport on Shy, not quite the equalizer, but this is definitely a very obvious window to start the Dragon.
Yes, it is. And they're just going to go for it instantly. Sol here with the advanced pink wards. They've tried to keep him safe while he can push. They want to get that top lane turret at least in return. You can see Secret now in the top side just to cover his ally. Dragon number two goes over to Spenu, but Sol is here to grab the top lane turret for his team. And he's got his buddies there to kill Shy if Shy gets too close. Shy will see the Death Squad lurking in the bushes. Jarvan not going to have an opportunity to get that second Cataclysm down.
Still a bit unconvinced by the Jarvan pickup. It feels like it's being played as if it's a Sejuani or a champion that really needs to farm to six. Because remember, he didn't show in a lane until he already had ultimate. This is a champion that has laning gank pressure from like one buff level two to actually just farm the jungle when you have instant CC and a Ryze in the Alistar combo and bottom. Why pick Jarvan?
Yeah, I agree. Just didn't make any even attempts at a play.
He didn't even look. He didn't even like get sin on a ward.
Nope. Just farmed. It's absolutely true. There was zero pressure coming out of the jungle.
Look, you understand it in some laning matchups. You know, if you don't have the likes of a Maokai or a Ryze to gank for in the top lane, sometimes it's difficult. You know, in the old days of Nidalee top lane, it would have been hard. But when you got instant CC, and then, of course, repeated instant CC with the nature of Ryze's Rune Prison, I mean, the jungle's not a happy place for Jarvan to be farming in the best of times. So really curious from Spenu.
Okay, well, he might be going for it now. Here we go. Misses the flag and Drek does not miss the Cataclysm. Shy is still there. He's got no health. Has to drop the Equalizer and just die. Ketch will get the kill, though. I know that was totally unnecessary.
Hope he gets a faster Aegis from it.
Yeah, that was totally unnecessary, but you're right. The faster Aegis will be very useful against CJ. A lot of that poke damage being magical from Kog'Maw. However, there's not really much that CJ can do to respond. Shy just kind of going out and dying. He will have the Abyssal Scepter complete now, and he's still up in CS, so it's not like he is hurting all that much. Coco gets a Chaos Storm dropped on him. No all-in. That'll be avoided thanks to Ambition's presence, but or will it? Ambition takes a very curious jungle path through the enemy side of the map. Madlife now here takes a little hook onto Secret, but nothing else. Ambition actually gets stopped in the middle of that Rek'Sai tunnel by a follow-up Rune Prison, but on the other side of the wall, so there's nothing they can really do.
Ryze just has to saunter back to the top lane. Hasn't been able to shop, so still has a very low mana bar. No dragon to contest, no realistic objectives to pick up because of all the wave clear in middle. Just a, just a bit of a splendid stroll down the mid lane.
Yeah, and CJ though, as we move into the next dragon fight, they've got two Abyssal Scepters now. So can they actually fight before Ryze really gets rolling? He's not going to have a fully stacked Rod of Ages yet. Victor and Corki and Ryze are going to do less damage once the Aegis comes through. So in terms of item timings, we could very well see CJ forcing a preferable team fight and engagement.
And to their credit, establishing a win condition with those first two early dragons, this team without a lot of engage needs to be fighting defensively, kiting back around around something like the Baron or the dragon. So feels like it's a very important thing, because if it was the other way around, if Spenu had the first two dragons, CJ would be running out of options already.
Yeah, absolutely agree. So, Space pushes the wave. Madlife there just to make sure he gets out of harm's way. They have a couple wards. Knew that Alistar was lurking around. Coco finally maybe getting close to finishing this turret. He's been working on it so hard for most of this game.
Even though he set his build back so far rushing the CDR home guards, credit to him. I believe those home guards have bought him. The fact that he's able to actually bat and pick up comparable item timings, he was behind in the Abyssal Scepter, but picked it up and kept his turret alive. That 475 gold has bought them maybe 7 minutes of outer turret time, which invaluable.
Yeah, that's absolutely huge. Prevented so many deep wards from going in as a result. Denied a lot of information that CJ would have been able to acquire quite easily. And also allowed Ryze to just keep farming up here, because if that turret goes down, certainly CJ starts setting their sights in this time period onto putting Kog'Maw in top lane and trying to get that rolling, maybe making it harder for the Ryze to scale. So can't really undervalue the fact that those home guards, like you said, have done so much work in this particular match.
Seems like we were on the ball with the Jarvan build. Aegis has finished very early. That's very important. Of course, it's only really negating the Abyssal Scepter. Given that there's two, we're expecting everyone on the team to be in range of the Abyssal Scepter. But still, a 2,000 gold purchase negating two expensive item purchases from CJ. So it's not ideal, but it's at least counteracting all the gold placed into magic penetration by CJ.
Well, certainly. You still have the Haunting Guys, though, and you still have the MR element, which coupled with CJ's own Aegis is making it very difficult for Spenu to actually kill them at the moment, particularly because Nuclear, not really going to have that Blade of the Ruined King finished yet, but Kog'Maw does. So in this next team fight that we could see, you expect CJ to come in with a pretty big edge. But can Spenu give up this dragon? They'd be giving up three. That would put them in a very precarious position come the late game. And that's right where CJ wants them.
Absolutely.
And they're starting to group up. Not really good wards down from Spenu.
The recall timing's also 10 seconds before third dragon.
That is just terrible.
And Nuclear was ahead in CS of the Kog'Maw. Didn't have the kill, so maybe that's why he didn't quite have the gold. But this is really, really poor cross-map play from Spenu. We're seeing Ryze back as well. They don't have the wards to contest. This is going to be a free third dragon as far as we can tell so far.
Unless they go for some crazy engagement. They are going to go for it, but are they going to be in time, actually? Looks like the smite going to be won by Ambition. Catch got immediately. Now they've got people on the flank, and they do just kill Catch on that side. The Kog'Maw's getting rolling. He's got Secret. Secret has to flash over the wall. Victor trying to kite back using that laser. And the Ghost, but can Coco catch up to him? Has to be worried about Nuclear on the flank. Does back off, so Sossin saved thanks to the damage threat from Nuclear. But that's a jungler down. It ended up being a bit of a 50-50, but the fight certainly wasn't because Catch was so far in advance of the rest of his team.
And look, first reaction you might think, okay, what's Catch doing so far away from his team? But honestly, he's paying for the sins of his teammates backing so late. They had to contest that dragon. Okay, he ended up woefully out of position, but that was only because the back timings, they just weren't respecting the dragon timer at all.
Yeah, and it also brings up the question, why would you choose the Corki with this composition? The Sivir is perfectly fine and maybe would have gotten the rest of the team there just enough faster to have made a difference.
Now you're left with a Corki that has two nice items, but you know, missing timings abound. They're not controlling Dragon, or Corki special with all his poke, and of course the Trinity Force auto attacks for burst. They're missing the turret taking timings because they're behind in turrets as well. Timings are such a core tenet of a successful Corki game. And Nuclear and his team have missed all of them in the first 25 minutes.
That's why I like their comp last game. It wasn't reliant on any timing whatsoever. They just had a very, very smooth scaling. And that meant that they could make mistakes like that and not be overly punished for them. Soul, and take a giant chunk out of Ambition's life, forces the flash.
Okay, so successful trade for sure. Soul, in terms of timings himself, only a minute away from, you know, those two big items. A lot of people move towards the Void stuff with the third, but Ryze certainly hitting his mid-game power. Maybe a minute or two late, but close enough to being online.
Yes, that is true. All right, well, I got excited, but Ryze not going to do anything about this Kog'Maw, except for get delayed, I guess. Has to run further back, thanks to the Living Artillery, before he can actually recall. Space wants this turret right now. Madlife there to help him out. Soul actually taking the long way around to the turret defense. He should be able to clear that wave with his ultimate, no problem.
Is at half mana though, so only has maybe one, two waves of clearing left before he's realistically going to have to go back. Starts pumping out the mana, taking a lot of harass, but still fairly healthy. Catches here, but standing on a ward.
Yeah, easily seen. Coco. Looks like they will deny the vision on that ward immediately. Pops it into this range of the lens.
Corki down bottom lane. Corki not grouping at 25 minutes. One of my saddest things to see. Like, okay, you missed the Trinity Force pass, but now you got the Blade of the Ruined King. You even got a pickaxe, and he's just doing nothing.
He also doesn't need to be farming right now.
Exactly, that's what I mean. You've got the power.
Wait for Ryze to get into the mid lane and take that wave. And defend your turrets in the meantime. CJ gets top lane for free. That pushes them out to a 4K lead. And a very patient Dragon game going to be incoming from CJ Entis. Nuclear is launching some rockets while he can. Can he get this mid lane turret though? Efficient there, but he doesn't. Corki doesn't have any backup. I mean, Sasan's taking wolves instead of pushing mid. They have wards around the top side of mid lane.
A very defensive wards. They're not pushed in at all to the Raptors or to the blue side. So realistically, moving across maybe halfway down the lane, it's a big risk.
Well, they are playing scared. That's for sure. And now CJ will just refocus onto bottom. See what wards they can get in as the 2 minute marker for Dragon ticks by at this stage. The setup has to be early. CJ looking much more convincing in this game compared to last. But you still have to be wary of that Ryze, even though Spenu is behind, even though they do have a lot of vulnerability to the magic resist. The Ryze always an issue. How many times have we seen around the world where the Ryze is behind, but he can single-handedly turn a game around?
You pump points into your E. That's, of course, a percentage magic resist shred as well. So even in the late game, Victor could be doing surprising damage. He's upped into a very early perfect hex score. You know, you get that shred on multiple members, the hex score is now going to be traveling fast. Every tick going to be registering. Going to be doing really big damage.
So let's see here what this Dragon fight will involve. Ambition and Madlife has just been sitting in the river, making sure that no vision is taken by Spenu. Spenu could try something risky, like trying to just dissuade them off that and attempt to threaten the Baron instead. That's probably their best call at the moment, because getting into the river now and clearing vision is going to be very, very difficult for them. And they have the wave pressure in the top side, so that side of the map belongs to them. Might as well try and get the Baron, really. That's it.
And in 30 seconds, if we see another 50-50 smite war like there was around the third dragon, Spenu's made a mistake, because they cannot afford to get in a situation where their out-leveled jungler gets outsmited and the game basically ends. This game will end very soon. Once the fourth dragon is registered, we're talking about win condition after win condition. We saw a teleport be used by Shy very defensively because he was just out of position.
Yes, he was. He was afraid of Soul coming up there to kill him. So now he's not going to have that. He's still going to be running from the base by the time the dragon spawns. They do not have a ward on Baron right now. That is CJ. So they can't see what's going on. Spenu really committing to going into the... They don't have vision here. They're trying to poke, but they're not doing much damage against all the MR.
Running straight at this CJ comp is exactly what they
it's
want.
Crazy. They have
excellent
Kai,
excellent zone control. The Equalizer will be layered down.
Just go for the Baron. There's no wards.
They can't hear you, Monte Cristo.
If I shout loud enough. Well, they're going to try and engage this, but CJ in a very good position. Nice knock up onto Coco. How much damage can he do? Madlife out on the side, but Coco just trying to kite this one out. There's an Equalizer. Doesn't hit anybody, actually. Shy coming in from the flank, but is he going to be too late to do much? He's on top of Sasan. Sasan's Chaos Storm not doing anything to that magic resist on Shy. They're going to take him out, so it will be a 3-for-1 so far. Kog'Maw goes down. Madlife, the second casualty on the part of CJ Entis. Soul wants to catch Ambition, but he's going to have to go under a turret to do it, and that is not going to be a chase that they can win. So yet another dragon to CJ. Spenu had total vision control of Baron. They could have at least threatened that. They can do that Baron super fast, but they don't do it, and they give up a fourth dragon for really nothing, and they lose the fight afterwards in spite of actually getting a good engage in. Shy completely whiffing his ult.
And as we watch this team, Monte Cristo, grow up in front of our eyes, win a game in 3 sets in a row. Last game we saw the lack of diving with the massive health stacks, the really big frontline tanks. This game, not playing around their power. The best teams, they get the wards down, they get the pinks down, they sweep it out, then they take an objective. Spenu did all those first things, but just opted into a fight where they were going to deal with an out-leveled smite anyway, so their chances now, there's a timer on this game. Ambition, it's gotten aggressive, but he has the lantern to get out. But now every 6 minutes there's that timer, Monte Cristo, and how are they going to play around the fifth dragon pressure?
Yeah, that is certainly something. I mean, Spenu obviously has a chance to get the Baron again, but now they have to trade it for dragon number 5, which is...
We just discussed that last game. It's not the best.
It's not the best. Well, it does depend on the composition, but given the poke range of CJ with that true damage, that is not good.
Let me tell you, if you get the fifth dragon and you are Rumble and every tick of the Equalizer is burning for true damage as well, it is disgusting.
Yeah. Yeah. Not to mention just the Kog'Maw Living Artillery. You hit a couple people with that and...
So much counterplay to the off-the-screen poke. Now we see the Baron being rushed by CJ. They get the Baron as well. You can pencil this into the record books.
Man. I mean, this is much better play from CJ Entis, but you can really see the missed opportunities here from Spenu.
Soul actually walking up to Koku, does a lot of damage, but has to know there's multiple members around. Headbutt Pulverize comes through. Can Catch actually get on top of anyone?
No, he can't. There's the Emperor's Divide, just shoves everybody right back now. They are going to stop the siege, at least for the time being, so getting some of that damage down does stall out CJ, and it's going to give Spenu some time to deal with the minion waves and prolong the time where they're not threatened by this Baron buff, so I guess it was a little bit worth it right there. Soul got the necessary damage. They also forced the some pretty nice ultimates out, but I'm not sure that it's going to matter. They may have bought themselves about 30 seconds, really.
But let's be realistic. You know, you've given away the Baron. You've given away four dragons. You're buying time. What are you buying the time for? Like, if I really think about this, are you buying the time till we get to 65 minutes, you still have inhibitors up, you win a team fight, and you win because the death timers are so high? It feels like that's the only thing that Spenu can really hope for, and that's pretty much praying to the Almighty.
Yeah, I totally agree. And not to mention that with the Baron buff, they're going to have the Baron buff long enough to take the next dragon, and you just can't push out those waves as quickly. So at a bare minimum, all CJ has to do is get in all three lanes at the same time, make sure they're pushed forward, take an easy fifth dragon, because the only thing that Spenu can hope for is that they get position on the dragon first. And there is definitely a way with a Baron buff for CJ to prevent them from doing that.
Well, we definitely need to check our mics, because it seems that Spenu can't hear us, but CJ, judging by this minimap, can definitely hear us pushing up all the lanes, playing very nice strategical play. Dragon's probably a couple of minutes away from being spawned, but yeah, I felt there'll be at least a 10 to 20 second overlap between Dragon spawning and Baron being up.
Yeah, this is not good.
Not good? Is that your expert word?
Not good.
Give me a bit more flavor. Not good's not good enough.
No, we just discussed how it's not good. There are many ways not good. There's very few chances for Spenu to actually take this home.
I feel like you could be a bit more severe with that word. I would say severe problems, alarm bells. Not good implies that there's light at the end of the tunnel. The light is so dim at this point.
The five alarm fire going on right now, and nope. Oh, nice, actually. Pulverize coming through, but Ambition just going to answer immediately with an Unburrow on top of the Equalizer. Soul is in the back line. Soul's going to not pick up a kill. Space is just doing way too much damage at this stage. And Soul not tanky enough to deal with that Kog'Maw, who just rips through the enemy team for a triple. Wow, I thought it was good when Soul got into the back, but after the Cataclysm was down, there was no way to contain space.
It was a wonderful flank ward, Monte Cristo. The issue was, he ate two Electro Harpoons, 80% slowed, couldn't actually get a Rune Prison on anyone, was sitting precariously about 700 range away. It's a game of inches sometimes, but was definitely denied by Shy.
Yeah, the free autos. Also important to note that space, there's no armor, so he just can buy an Infinity Edge right now. That is quite easy. There's no concern for him when it comes to actually dealing damage or buying armor penetration. Last Whisper, kind of useless, so they don't catch space. Sigrid going to respond with a flash pull.
It's a wonderful equalizer. You see Ryan's come through, but watch the slows. He just can't do anything. He just gets free autoed. Eventually they turn onto him, and he just dies instantly to the Blade of the Ruined King in an auto attack. And from there, you know, Catch isn't tanky. This is the Jarvan that didn't get snowballed in the early game. Now ults and dies.
Well, when you don't have a Frozen Heart, man, that Ryze just falls so fast to a Kog'Maw with those kind of two forms of percent HP.
I think he actually didn't use his Seraph's Embrace Shield, so that probably would have helped a little bit. It's still available. It's got quite a long cooldown. Spenu kind of has to fight around Fifth Dragon, but this gold lead's reminiscent of the one they had last game, almost 10,000.
Yeah, so Spenu has to go for the Miracle Steal. There's the Engage coming from the Righteous Glory. But it's not going to be enough. Catch trying to get an angle. Now, they should just fight this immediately. Catch gets hooked in. Sigrid already solo. There is the Equalizer. Dragon resets. That's not an option any longer. And everybody gets pulverized thanks to the Emperor's Divide. Space has the Chaos Storm swirling over him, but that's not going to do anything, really. It's just going to heal right back off of this dragon. So it will be the fifth one for CJ. Methodical play here from this Entis team.
But methodical play with necessity. Last series we talked about, okay, be assertive, dive a turret. Spenu didn't do that, but still won. This game, if CJ didn't get control around Dragon or Baron, they had no other way to win the game, but they did exactly what they needed to. Got the only Baron of the game, got the fifth Dragon sack. Sassen's out of position, and this is going to be all square two games in.
Yeah, Sheen and Azir going to make short work with fifth buff. Secret goes in, but nope, not really going to do much. Even through that Unbreakable Will, Sassen, or Ketch rather, has to just flash out, afraid of that tremendous amount of damage, and that's it. CJ Entis takes home game number two, sending us into the third set with ease. They were never behind that game. Very calmly played. Great shot calling from CJ. Not much to complain about.
Yeah, they bring in their A-listers, they bring in their stars, and they play much more controlled League of Legends. As you said, felt like they were really responding to what we were saying in terms of just playing the map smartly, understanding their win conditions, monopolizing the Dragon, and what was Spenu to do?
Yeah, well, Spenu, I actually did like their team comp overall. I think that it had some potential, but unfortunately, even though Seoul actually eventually managed to get kills, it just wasn't enough. There wasn't anyone to deal with the Kog'Maw. No armor. Kog'Maw just runs amok. They have no lockdown onto him, even though they try to get into that back line. And just Shy's peeling was very good.
I think it's a different game where we don't have to point out the fact that level six Jarvan had not ganked once in the game.
Problematic, to say the least. So a victory for CJ Entis. They really need to champ select. And the big gamble for CJ, putting all on Trick.
Trick or treat.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. That's pretty much it. Is it Halloween? Okay, so Shen, Kalista, Nidalee, bans coming in fast. The Nidalee ban once again. We saw it against Trick in game one. Now, Ambition also a Nidalee player to a certain degree, certainly not his priority.
And does Ryze escape the bans once again? Of course, Ryze was on the losing side in the previous game. Seoul himself had a tough time in lane and then was well dealt with in team fights. It's just, do you leave a ticking time bomb out on the field and then get surprised if it blows up in your face?
You gotta defuse it fast, Papa Smithy.
I mean, the easy way to defuse it is right here, right now. Just ban it.
Just ban it out. Don't let him play it.
What else is really in contention?
Ezreal.
That's
Ezreal's
true.
Up this game.
And this is Sassen, of course, noted mid-Ezreal player. Do you lock it in first pick? It feels like if you don't, Coco's gonna take it.
I think you do take it right now if you're CJ Entis, but they like that Rek'Sai, or the Azir. And Azir does have that good laning phase against the Runeglaive Ezreal too. So there is that potential to go for it. We could see the jungle Ekko.
That's what we've been hoping for, hoping and praying for. Ekko does a lot of interesting things, but with Kog'Maw's win rate only being enhanced today after a win last game, man, the priority of Kog'Maw's gone up and up. But if you keep answering with Corki, it's going to keep winning.
Yeah. That's about all you can say, right, is that if you give Kog'Maw that winning laning phase, then there's not really a downside to picking the Kog'Maw unless you have some pretty nasty backline flank. And also, Kog'Maw's rise has kind of coincided with the decrease of Hecarim use, which actually would be a viable way to deal with it. But Hecarim's laning phase and the fact that he's so item-dependent have made him much less attractive. And they're just going to take the Maokai so they can have the Kog'Maw for free.
I was going to think, you know, with Cinderhulk top laners falling out of the meta, which top laner exists that is a realistic threat to Kog'Maw that's in the meta? It's the Maokai, and they actually just lock it in with it. Now, this does give up the AP Ezreal. 2-0 on this champion. Hard to cherry-pick winning win rates in terms of champion picks for Spenu. Of course, they haven't done a lot of winning. This is definitely one of them.
Yeah, and most of Spenu's wins have been Sassen hard carrying the team, which he can do on a champion with so much poke and damage like this Runeglaive Ezreal. No one has had that answer.
I want to see something interesting here. They're flashing some interesting champions. Of course, the Blitzcrank, just a shout out to Madlife. But
all right, Coco, play Vel'Koz into it. Be the ultimate BM pick. That's what I want.
Do you flex the Ekko?
Ekko?
And they're flexing the Ekko as well.
So they grab the Braum. Now, here's what I don't like about Spenu's draft. If you want to take Ezreal in that round, you also take the Braum. I think you just give it up because taking the Braum denies the fact that CJ has an ability to play against you.
Thinking about Corki, please no. For one, opting into a 2v2 against DeBrom, not happy days for Corki. So easy to block that phosphorus bomb with the Unbreakable. And we just talked about the fact that the lane matchup, it's horrible. So, I don't know.
I like it when teams take the Braum in conjunction with the the Ezreal. Otherwise, you just give people too many tools to deal with it. We haven't even seen the mid lane yet, so. And we've seen also Anarchy try and flash that Yasuo to dissuade any kind of Ezreal mid usage.
I'd be very excited to see the Olaf that we've been kind of hoping and praying for. I mean, Smite Teleport Olaf was kind of a whisper in the wind a few patches ago, but never saw it, at least in Champions. And look at that last bit. They certainly did flex the Echo, as Twisted Fate from Coco is the answer.
Well, I don't think Echo is really mid-viable on this patch. It did lose a lot of its actual assassin power with the nerfs. So you're playing it mostly for utility these days, and the fact that you still have damage, even though you don't have to build AP with your passive. So the frontline threat is, I mean, they have so much tankiness in the front here and so much zone control, CJ does, and they have the ability to make plays onto two lanes with crowd control with TF. That is pretty brutal.
Ambition is going to be sitting in the back and being envious of the lanes that Trick has to gank, because what do you want if you're an Echo and you're ganking lanes? You want CC targeted in the lanes. Twisted Fate, Maokai, both having targeted CC. Oh, you just throw out the parallel convergence. It's so easy. It's point and click almost, and then the kills start coming.
I really like this team composition.
It's excellent.
CJ.
I was going to say,
really, really good.
This is, for a red side drop, beautiful.
Yeah, just saving the TF until the end, too. They have a way to block a lot of AP as's damage with that Unbreakable from Madlife. There's the poke. It's very easy to itemize MR here for CJ with these mega tanks in the front line. And they have so many just ganking options, so many engage options, so many kiting options with how many zones they can control at one time. This is CJ. This is a totally meta comp with the rise of TF. And we are going to get in the game. We'll see how CJ can play it out.
Just licking my lips at the deliciousness of this team comp, Monte Cristo.
Honestly, he's getting excited when he should be shutting up.
Have you seen what CJ has put together on this red side?
It's beautiful. It is really, really good.
So, Spenu, they've got the Rune Glaive of Ezreal. It's 5.12, only probably for today. We don't have 100% confirmation, but expecting 5.13 next week. Can Sarsen do it again? Because, man, I was going to say the odds are stacked against him. I saw the Twisted Fate, but I'm still going to say it. It's a hard game for Ezreal to win.
Yes. Yes, it is. There would have to be a lot of mistakes here for Ezreal to actually get into a place of crazy power. Because TF, we talk about this Ezreal, he just doesn't have the wave clear. And this is going to open up Coco so hard to roaming around the map. I mean, Catch basically has to be a warding god here to actually try and suss out where and when this TF is going somewhere. Coco has the freedom to take the Ghost in this matchup too. Doesn't have to be worried about having to take Cleanse at all. This is an excellent situation for CJ Entis. Not to mention, the last time Coco played this TF, he played it against Jhinair, and he dominated that game. If he didn't have just an incredible game, they would have lost. So we know he can put up on the TF.
And we knew that was a game where he needed kind of a faker level carry to make things work. As you mentioned, they were quite far in the hole that game. You look down their comp and their win conditions and just the strength of the lanes they've picked, he doesn't need that sort of a performance. If he just goes even, you know, shows up with a couple of stuns to amplify the CC already in lanes. Again, jungle's paradise for Trick, though. This is maybe the real acid test for Trick when it comes to being a top-level competitive jungler, because he's got wonderful ganks to gank for.
Yeah, he does, and he also has the luxury of not having to gank at all, though. It's a pretty easy game to jungle if you're Trick, because you could just let Coco do all the heavy lifting and farm if you need to. You can even just cover for Coco's lane while he's TPing. There's not a lot here. If he doesn't want to make plays, he certainly doesn't have to.
So we've got very excited, even during the break, about good old CJ's draft. What does Spenu have, and how do they at least put themselves within a position to at least make it competitive? It feels like, you know, with the Rumble, can they try and force something around Dragon earlier? They have the Rune Glaive of Ezreal, so they have two smites, but the wave control, as you mentioned, is going to be tough.
It's going to be so hard. Well, Trick is actually starting on top side jungle and going down to bottom, so the Rumble will have some freedom to push up. They're going to go for an invade right now onto the blue buff. Not sure about this one. Their little converge is going to come down. Trick only level 2, throws out the Time Winder. Uh-oh. Secret has to use Pulv, and he's going to headbutt Trick over to catch. There's the exhaust. It's already out. Coco has the first right of response here. Space also coming in. Catch is down. And Secret actually picking up that kill.
It doesn't look like it's done.
That was just a terrible idea. And they're going to miss the Winter's Bite, but they got one more auto for the stun, and Coco will pick it up with a stacked deck. Wow. Not sure why you would invade that blue buff when you do not have control over the mid lane. Certainly they had control over the bottom side, but MetLife showed up awful quick. And Coco has that. He has CC in the early game, and Ezreal's got Jack Diddley.
He's going to smite. That's pretty useful.
Yeah, you go ahead, smite some champions, you know.
Yeah, the big issue there was that you could see it on the minimap. Nuclear was going to get to the trade much faster. Big issue. Ghost Flash Twisted Fate with CC. I mean, you need to communicate if you're the mid laner or whoever's making the shot call that there's no way that Ezreal, I mean, he still has his flash up, but there's no way he can impact in any way a skirmish compared to a level 3 Twisted Fate.
Yeah, you can't do that.
It's not in his kit.
It's not in his kit. And also, summoner spells are so important in the early game before you have any items. That's such a determining factor between how a lot of these matchups go. And looks like the first blue buff of the game is actually going to be handed to Sossin. So they really want, all their eggs are in the Sossin basket now with how that jungle has gone. And the fact that Coco has that kill, Sossin needs to have as much mana as possible just to push out and not lose a ton of CS to the turret.
And just stay in lane now, probably till he finishes his Rune Glaive. It's probably going to be a very big first purchase when he finally gets to it. I really love the fact that Braum's been coming back into the meta. This is a champion who got the buff on the Q, so of course his laning phase and the pressure is a lot higher, but he also fits the meta. He's excellent against poke champions. If you can just use that Unbreakable, if you get the AP Ezreal ultimate, my goodness, it's a one team fight.
Yeah, so much damage blocked. You're talking about negating about 800,000 damage late in the game. So you could absolutely turn things around if that was going to AoE your team.
But laning phase against Corki, wonderful. Team fight against AP Ezreal, wonderful. Braum used to be pigeonholed into counter engage, but he does so much this game, man. I still take a turret shot. Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. Still was able just to hop to a minion to get out. Still end up on the worst side of that trade, but not that big of a deal right now. Still has biscuits to spare.
Most nutritious biscuits in the league.
They're the only ones, though, so.
That's true. We need more biscuits. So where do you fall on the biscuits and cookie argument?
Cookies.
All right. What sort
I'm
of
American.
Cookies?
I'm American.
Okay, but what sort of cookies are we talking?
Oh man. I only really like homemade cookies.
Okay, but what's in this homemade cookie?
I'm pretty standard. I like oatmeal, chocolate chip, you know? Nothing too crazy. Don't like white chocolate, it's too sweet.
Is that just a standard rule or white chocolate cookies?
White chocolate in general.
Fair enough.
Too sweet. I'm more of a dark chocolate kind of guy, you know?
You know, I kind of guessed that about you.
Especially with sea salt, that's lovely.
Mmm.
Bittersweet with sea salt, that's where it's at. Nothing too sweet. I don't have much of a sweet tooth. You do, though. You love candy.
I do love candy. Kind of with you on the white chocolate, though. That was more of a kid passion. You know, the Milky Bar back in Australia, very tasty white chocolate. But nowadays, yeah, the chocolate chip, I think, pretty stock standard, myself.
Not too crazy in terms of your...
I mean, the M&Ms from Subway, maybe, you know? That's probably as far as I'll push it on the sweet tooth.
I really like M&Ms, honestly.
Well, at least now I know I don't have to share them with you. You know? That's a good thing. I know what cookies to buy.
That's great. I'm glad. If you can find good cookies in Korea, they're not really big here.
Hmm.
Okay, well, Ketch just going to get out of the mid lane as Coco and MetLife coordinate their pink ward clearage. Plus, you call them biscuits. I mean, come on.
I call them Tim Tams, but... That's a bit more specific, very Australian. Needed a shout out to Tim Tams. Wonderful biscuits.
Get out of here with your British words.
Do you say soda or pop?
Soda. Mm. Pop is very Midwestern in America.
These are the lessons I need to know. You know, I don't know much about America.
Dola would say pop. He's from
Do you
Minnesota.
Think he really? I've never seen him order a pop.
I think he's probably learned from being outside of the Midwest, but that's definitely super Midwestern to say that.
I usually just say a Coke, and it kind of means Pepsi and Coke.
Yeah. That means Coke has won the branding war, Papa Smithy.
I'm okay with it.
Okay. Do you just let Coke win?
I'm mainstream. Coke, Nike, give it to me. I love it. Coco, doing the standard Twist of Fate thing, just stepping out of lane, running the same skin that Messiah was famous for, so. Trying to see some big Twist of Fate plays. Hasn't needed to. I mean, his first play was actually pre-Destiny. How often do we say that? It wasn't even the first Destiny, but it was the first use of summoners that kind of won them the early game.
Yeah, and now they have both of them back up, so the timing is right. The blue cards, Ezreal, right in his face. You deserve that, Ezreal. You are broken right now. Get out of this game.
Oh, don't worry. Riot's well on top of it.
I will say what's nice about the Runeglaive Ezreal is at least there are ways to deal with him, right?
Sure.
It's not like you can just pick him and he's powerful at all phases of the game. There is counterplay available, but it has definitely shaped the meta of this patch as to how you draft, because you have to have that in the back of your mind if you're not going to just outright ban him. With a number of other power picks, it becomes difficult to do that.
And for all the hype of kind of free win or massively overpowered, which probably was a bit justified against Ryze a couple of patches ago, people worked around the Ezreal surprisingly well. Maybe that's just the amazing minds of champions, but people have come up with multiple different strategies to shut down this mid lane Ezreal.
Yeah. Still bad, though. I mean, the worst that I've seen in competitive play was Zac. That was terrible. As we see, Catch not going to get the stun onto him from the concussive blows, but a little bit of damage, but that will wrap up the blue buff. No way they can contest this now. Trick and Madlife with the engage, and you know, Trick really looking a lot more on point when he's got somebody else to shot call in this game, one would assume.
I mean, once again, jungler's paradise. You cannot use overstate. Maokai and Twist of Fate to gank for both targeted CC, one of them even ranged for an Ekka. We haven't seen that lane pressure, but 1-0-1 from the earliest scraps. If you're not feeling hyped up on power when you've got Madlife roaming with CC, when you've got the Destiny to ensure that your mid lane goes
there.
There
we
first.
Go. There's the parallel conservative. It's just endless stuns. Soul doesn't have a chance in hell.
And they did
Shy
that really badly.
Kill.
And still
yes,
did.
They did. They did.
Didn't even matter. Now, Spenu have a lot more numbers on the bottom side of the map. Madlife shows up there, though. Can they answer with a dragon to at least make CJ pay for a super sloppy turret? Though?
I don't know. Madlife and Space actually are forcing them off the objective. Shy still has TP. They can't do this, actually. Because even if Sol has TP, his ultimate is down. Yeah, that was actually very sloppy, as you were saying. They stacked the CC, number one, a little bit. You couldn't really tell because all of those stuns are so long. And then they didn't commit to the kill. They took a couple extra turret shots, and they didn't have to.
I mean, Trick, honestly, should have gone harder and then just ulted to drop aggro and get the heal. For some reason, he just walked out of turret range trying to hold on to that selfish cooldown. And then, you know, Coco hit a red card, then walked away. Like, it was really, really poor turret dive and didn't even matter.
No, certainly did not.
They have two people that can drop aggro between Maokai and the Ekko, and they still managed to butcher it, Monte Cristo.
Oh, boy.
Well, Spenu are praying for late game. It got them two wins with Runeglaive Ezreal before. It's certainly not out the window, but you feel like if you see two dragons stacked up for CJ, maybe this game already going to be a little bit out of reach for Spenu.
Yeah, this is... at what point do you really start to fight this? If you're Spenu and the dragons start getting out of control for CJ... Nice doubling down, getting a little bit wave clear there. Nearly clipping Space.
The worst feeling when you're walking back to lane is taking 300 damage and be like, do I go back? I mean, late game, that's why Ezreal's so strong, is that you just throw out those ultimates haphazardly and cause recalls, and Sol can't even get anywhere near his turret, and that's the reality when you're facing Maokai.
Easy turret take. First one of the game down in favor of CJ Entis. Coco backing off as he sees Secret pop out of a brush on the bottom side of his lane. Now, just more movement through the enemy jungle. They're starting to ward up that top side. Still no movement on the dragon, so it looks like we're going to have a pretty late first dragon.
And I guess we can kind of turn around my point. You know, we're talking about two dragons down. Okay, how does Spenu get back in this game? If the second dragon's only being contested when we see another item or two on the Ezreal, you know, that's the one thing is, when you start getting these neutrals going, that stops people from just infinitely scaling. It's why we don't see the Anivia stall comps anymore, is that Baron and Dragon are such big win conditions.
I'm really thankful for that, Bob Smith.
I mean, I'm so happy that every time someone picks Ziggs, they lose, because Baron buff just ruins Ziggs' main, you know, he can't clear waves anymore. What can he do?
Whoop.
Oh. Yeah, take that. 200 damage. Pop that potion.
He sure showed Coco. Coco is just going to red card his way to some more wave clear. Has fallen behind when it comes to CS, but only ever so slightly. And we're just waiting here for someone to make that first dragon move. Madlife getting a couple hits onto nuclear, but nothing else to actually pop that stun.
I guess the safest thing CJ could do would be have Maokai push into the inner turret and then, you know, force inner turret damage trade for teleporting over for Soul. But realistically, with all the lanes that they have and the Destiny backup, it's whenever they want it, CJ.
Right. And pushing forward, not really going to be too helpful if they want to follow up another gank onto the Rumble. Like you said, realistically, the best thing they could do is push up to tier 2 and then just have Maokai walk over to Dragon and then force a TP. But even then, it's not that big of a play in the long run. Uh-oh. Exhaust out on Assassin. There's a stun into a stun. Goodbye. Trick picks it up with the Time Winder, but very methodical. You can't. I mean, the concussive blows right into a gold card is pretty brutal.
But honestly, whenever I see a control mage like Victor, like Ezreal in those situations, I'm waiting for the cleanse. But when you got the smite, Monte Cristo, nothing you can do.
And there's the actual gold card on to catch. Now, Shy is over here. Even though he's going to have to flash for it, they will just get some more targeted CC. Shy pops the Maelstrom, and that is a kill over to CJ Endes. They're now 5-0 on that count, so very nice play there. Much cleaner than their first dive. Very calculated play. Madlife already deep in the enemy jungle was able just to box in Sasin and make sure they grabbed it. This turret's not going to last long, though. Lichbane already done for Coco, so it will fall.
And breaking the outer turret against the Ezreal, only really has the ultimate for instant wave clear. It's not looking good for Spenu as they're going to start losing control over everything. We're watching them lose their blue buff right under their noses.
Without that blue buff. Oh, actually nice smite it out. Nicely done. Was able to pick up the burst. Shy now. Not really in trouble. He can't get out of this situation. Well, or can he? He doesn't have flash anymore, so he just kind of has to walk very slowly. But a missed Q and a missed harpoon will force the flash. He has to go on to Sasin, but there's no follow-up. So he's going to fall, hand the red buff to Sasin. And what can they get for it? Nothing really. Coco out of mana.
Amazing that the first dragon hasn't fallen. Nuclear, one stack of the Braum passive. Draws out a teleport, though.
No equalizer. Interesting. You can try and make a play right here with Secret. True Shot Barrage going to go wide left of space and Madlife. So they commit three people in an ultimate, rather, to the bottom, but don't really come away with anything besides keeping their turret up for the moment.
All Spenu have to be happy about is that 16 minutes in, very late first dragon going to be coming out this game. No dragon even started 16 minutes in.
Well, speak of the dragon.
Speak of the dragon.
Are going to pick it up here. No contest. Everyone already back for Spenu, so clean dragon attempt. Sasa can try to actually pull off a True Shot Barrage, but not going to decide to do so.
Anyways, that was safe to the point that they even knew the teleport was down from Souls. They even had teleport advantage, so rudimentary to pick up the dragon. 16 minutes means the fifth dragon's gonna be very late. Speculative ult, but no blue busting.
Yeah. Instead, Coco will take it. This composition is really interesting to me, Papa Smithy. We haven't really talked about this, but the meta is shifting. You and I were talking about this Twisted Fate earlier today. We're seeing it pop up more and more and more. He suffers when it comes to assassins, but when assassins are way down in the meta, TF inevitably makes his return because he has so much presence and utility. And that's what we're seeing right now. If you can safely pick the Twisted Fate, if you're not worried about a Fizz mid, and also AP Fizz isn't as good as he used to be either. Still going to be solid against a TF because you can dodge the card, the pick a card, but it's not as good as it once was.
Even that classic laning matchup isn't as good because if you miss the fish, you used to have immense kill pressure. Don't have any more. Two teleports coming through. One of them, the Destiny.
Oh, and goodbye, Nuclear. No chance. CJ just playing this to a T. And when you have this much mobility, I mean, there's just so much you can do with this composition. With the Kog'Maw coming back against current AD laners, he has that dominant laning phase. You have so many options for crowd control with TF and Echo and Braum. You can block the poke composition. So CJ, this is the composition we're going to be seeing more of in the future.
We see Catch taking two auto attacks, not going to get stunned up. I think it's one of those classic League of Legends, you know, meta changes. You know, when you have next patch going to be more sustained mid laners in terms of staying damage with the Rylai's and Leandre's getting strong. Twisted Fate. Kog'Maw are always going to rise when assassins are out of the meta, and that's what we're seeing right in front of our eyes.
Yeah. And likely, too, we're not going to see that many meta shifts before Worlds, really. I think this AP itemization, I don't have any inside info, but I think this AP itemization is probably the last really big change we're going to see, because Riot is very adamant about not making these huge, huge changes immediately before the World Championship. And if you remember, especially last year, we came in to Worlds on the same patch for like, the same patch was there for 2 months. It was a really long time in the lead up and then during the month-long World Championship itself. And considering that that is knocking on the door right now, we'll probably not see too many changes.
I just love the fact that the Kog'Maw picks in particular make so much sense with the last, say, 4 or 5 patch cycles. So when the Assassin meta was in, no Kog'Maw. Enough said, we understand that. Cinderhulk top laners, another wonderful way of dealing with a Kog'Maw and his lack of escape. They're out of the meta. No Shyvanas, no
Sejuani.
No Sejuani. All these champions keep getting pushed out of the meta, and suddenly, backline threat just gets less and less prevalent. You know, that's why we see champions like Jayce, champions like Ezreal, the poke meta we're talking about. Now we're going to see sustained damage mid laners. We're going to see the Rylai's, the Leandre's mid laners. That's why people say, what about Graves? Maybe it's time for bursts to come from the AD carry role, because no one else is going to provide it. There's no LeBlanc anymore. Literally, the mid lane assassin meta is the occasional Zed and the occasional Fizz.
Yeah, that's it. There's nothing left. Should be fun to see, though. You know, we're also talking, what about the Vel'Koz?
What about excellently Leandre's Rylai's user.
Yeah.
Brand? Can we dream about the mid lane Brand one time?
Yeah. Certainly possibilities coming forward.
And then do they need to buff LeBlanc to deal with these pesky control mages?
Hey, I'm okay with it. I love watching LeBlanc. I don't know what everybody else's problem is.
No LeBlanc, Monte Cristo. Oh. It's gone. It's gone. It's never coming back. It's probably coming back. Suspender just clearing their wave. Destiny's popped.
Oh, here's the gate. Will it actually catch anybody? Soul is the target. Soul gets knocked around by the Arcane Smash. And that's it. Dies very quickly to the burst, but there's the Arc. Oh, man. The True Shot Barrage blocked by the Unbreakable. And now Trick just on the run. They do get Mad Life, but I mean, they still have to deal with the Kog'Maw on the bottom side. And they haven't really gotten any more control out of this laning phase.
So much CC. Those four members have just a permanent CC bar worth of CC. I mean, when this is an Ezreal, we mentioned the fact that as a control mage having to take Smite, you basically need a QSS, but you don't even have the damage to potentially work one into your build. So even the great AP Ezreal.
The answering teleport play, though. Soul looking for space there. He's going to get cooked. You are a cooked Void Worm. Barbecue.
What do you think it goes with a side of? Cooked Kog'Maw?
Cooked Kog'Maw. Koguma, which is sweet potatoes in Korean.
Oh.
Kog'Maw and Koguma, see? Works.
Interesting. I didn't know that. Today I learned. The only sweet potato I see here is on my pizza. A lot of sweet potato pizza.
There's a lot of sweet potatoes in general. You can get them as street food, actually. They roast them for you. They're delicious. It is also good on pizza. That is one of the Korean standard.
So no corn?
No corn. Koguma is okay.
Okay. I'll remember to ask that next time. Has Trick used his ultimate this game?
He did in the last dive.
All right.
To get out. When he went onto the Rumble, he used it.
It's not quite a Zed situation, because of course, just mostly using it for dropping aggro, whether it's CC or turret aggro respectively, but not have much course for it. And unfortunately for Spenu, this game has basically panned out as expected from the pick and ban.
Yeah, there's not much more to say. CJ just playing this pretty methodically. Maybe a bit of a reckless dive onto the Rumble where they've lost their pressure edge, but...
How reckless is it when you have so much targeted CC, though?
Like how Coco just gates right next to the rest of his team. No need to get in that back line just yet. He'll be happy kiting with that massive front line that he has. There's a great pulverize, though. And there's the Equalizer coming in after it. Bad Life gets the Glacial Fissure down, but Soul starts to stack up. That passive from Braum saws him, gets some damage down, but they eventually take out the Alistar, and they're still pursuing. Heal used to catch Soul with a gold card, and now the Rumble will fall to the Focus Fire from the TF and the Kog'Maw.
In a different game, that would have been a game-winning Headbutt Pulverize, triple or quadra Headbutt Pulverize from Secret. Excellently layered Equalizer, but with the gold disadvantage already that they find themselves in, just didn't do enough damage to CJ Enters.
Right, and it's also extra surprising that it didn't do damage because we don't even see an Aegis yet. You'd think that would be the key item that they would need to cut down on Spenu's damage, but...
Abyssal Scepter, Merc Treads, Spirit Visage,
yeah,
like, apart
enough.
From space, they actually have got a lot of selfish magics with their extra gold, but this is unbelievable engage. That's just like Wolf a couple of days ago. It layered
Beautiful.
It, but what did you notice? Mad Life blocked out the AP Ezreal ultimate.
Once again, and I mean, the parallel convergence there too to keep Secret. They turn on him for the kill once the Unbreakable Will goes down. And then look at the Summoner heal, just for the catch-up right there with the flash. Very nicely played.
And just CC for days is the CJ Entis mantra this particular game. And against an Ezreal, who we mentioned, cannot itemize in a QSS or take Summoner Cleanse. Sassen just can't put out the damage that his team needs, or they was able to the last two times out.
Okay, so after that, Baron is next up on the checklist for victory for CJ Entis. Divine Secret, the Ward, and a Winter's Bite.
So where's Sassen on the AP Ezreal spiraling out of control item build? He's got the core. What does he need?
I mean, at this point, now the Aegis is finished, does he really have the necessary magic penetration to really make this work? He's decided to go, of course, for the cooldown boots this game because he needs that CDR, so he just is not running with any pen besides his runes and masteries.
The most worrying thing for him is that, you know, Mad Life's on form, blocks that ultimate.
Yeah.
That's basically, what, 60% of his damage potential gone?
Maybe 50%. Off of a full combo?
Sure. But it's still, like, his ult is the reason why he's so powerful.
Yes.
People saying, nerf AP Ezreal ult. No, the ult's always been good. It's just that laning phase wasn't possible. Laning phase has gotten better, but this particular comp deals with it oh so well.
I have to be worried about Coco's eventual ability just to get on top of Ezreal in the back line, too. That's just another form of shutdown that they have. They don't even have to necessarily get the Maokai. You just poured in with the TF. Looks like he's not going to be going for Azonius anytime soon, so that won't be viable. But
and that's probably the most fun thing about casting a TF game is you can look at the item build and go, okay, this is what he wants to do with these items. If there's no Zhonyas, you're not porting on top of the enemy AD carry or the immobile. Or the squishy AP Ezreal, you're more playing the poke game, you're more playing the positioning-based game. So, yeah, I mean, with the Lich Bane early, haven't seen a lot of split pushing, but now it's really starting to hit top gear.
It is. So Coco, still moving through the minion waves on his split pushing mission. Sassen, assigned to the lane just to stop him. At least he has good wave clear now with that rune glaive. He can't match it.
Spenu just kind of caught with maybe, you know, access to the Raptors at most. They don't really have much jungle control whatsoever, especially in the top side. And when you lose top side dragon control, Baron's a pretty trivial objective.
Coco stealing the cruds, just salting the wound, as it were, as CJ will turn, actually. Gate used, and there we see the True Shot Barrage. Bad Life flashes, forces a flash of his own. Mad Life moving backwards right now. Coco did gate up into the top side of the mid lane, but CJ can't actually finish the Baron off of that.
Surprising to me that that was enough pressure to actually cause them to get off the Baron. I mean, they had the extra vision, they had the permanent vision for the, you know, 8 to 10 seconds of the gate, but still chose to back away, obviously respecting the potential damage coming through from the likes of the Equalizer.
Trick was very low. too. He had been tanking that Baron without Shy because Shy was still in the lane, in top lane, so they were trying to sneak it out. If they had Shy there, I think they probably would have gone back Shy earlier, that is. And now the death cap for Coco. He is a frontline killer this game. He just wants to kill the Rumble every time. And the Alistar.
Death cap for Coco.
Death cap for Coco.
If Dolan was here, he'd talk about one of his many emo rock bands.
That is a fantastic one.
I'd probably listen to their, you know, their cover.
I would not.
No?
No.
Sad days. Emumu.
Maybe he'll play the death cap Emumu someday. We get another show match. Have busted
tear into death cap Emumu.
Oh, fancy pathing there with the Rek'Sai tunnels. Gets him mostly out of the poke, even though he took the initial barrage. And CJ just really wants this Baron. They know how to finish this game. You get the Baron buff, you have the Kog'Maw, you have that huge amount of siege with the Lich Bane TF, and you take it home.
I mean, if you want to be super safe, third dragon spawning very soon. That's going to be largely uncontested from Spenu, so the extra movement speed might help if they kite away.
Oh, but Nuclear is just getting destroyed.
Everyone who walks up into auto attack range is getting destroyed.
I'm actually surprised they're splitting with the TF in the bottom side when Gate is more useful out of the top side.
That's fair.
And Maokai is more useful out of bottom with TP. That's a bit strange to me.
I guess the idea to me is you're going to draw someone that can effectively split push against Twisted Fate and there's less collapse pressure onto the Baron, perhaps? But yeah, it's kind of pulling things from the ethers. The third dragon, easily taken by CJ.
The problem is that when you pull the Rumble down there, she has actually the global, so it could in fact be a 5v4 for Spenu for a brief period of time in top lane. That's why I don't like it.
That's fair. The defensive wards are good for Spenu. They just can't quite push them towards the Baron. I think one of the problems, honestly, for CJ Entis.
Coming in, there's the gate. Coco threw a gold card at somebody, but it will stun catch on the opposite side of the wall.
But one thing I'm disappointed at, with only one sweeper, they just can't clear vision. They just haven't felt comfortable enough. The only way to do that is go back, spend 250 gold on your two sweeper members already, and start sweeping it out, because there's a lot of defensive vision creeping towards the Baron.
I mean, they should just bait the Baron and turn and fight right now. They have such a severe gold lead that it doesn't really matter if they take a little bit of Secret actually going in. There's the TP. Mad Life on the outside. Catch already chunked out of this fight. They will try to use the Equalizer. That's not going to be enough, but it will be with the True Shot Barrage. Not blocked by Mad Life this time, but there is a huge parallel convergence, and Shy is here now. Shy is in the choke, CCing the entire team. And so they get Mad Life, but they trade two and then three members for its Soul, Nuclear, and Secret all falling. That'll be a Baron.
And it was an even more calculated fight, Monte Cristo, because Sarsen had no mana. They've been spending so much time contesting that blue buff. No blue buff, couldn't refill the mana. Of course, Coco low, but has the blue card potential. And the Baron comes down to perhaps seal the win for CJN.
Yeah, they finally got it. Bad Life won't have it, but that is pretty inconsequential. Baron buff not going to do much for a support anyway. You see that they tried to get the speed up from the summer heal, but it didn't quite work. But look at that parallel convergence. Look how well CJ just cuts off the exit route with the Maokai right after the Echo W. Makes it very easy to clean up the fight.
And speaking of easy, Space took what? A Rage Pulverize from the basically dead Secret right at the end of the fight, and no other source of damage from anyone.
Space has been very well protected.
It's the reality of the Kog'Maws. You know, you don't see the Shyvanas, you don't see the Mundos, you don't see the champions that can kind of run and force Kog'Maw to make bad positioning moves. Maybe a bit of a surprise we don't even see the Jinx, because it feels like Hyper Carries, they're back in the meta.
Oh, nice block from Mad Life,
but
he
anyway.
Gets it anyway. Sarsen. So saucy.
That was probably the most equal contest we'll see for the rest of this game. That was cool.
That was cool.
So even the AP Ezreal doesn't have the wave against his Baron buff minions. Lich Bane Twisted Fate pushing in with the Baron buff minions. Full court press from CJ as we see Kog'Maw pushing the top lane.
Yep, all the tier twos falling in sequence right now. Soul gets ulted and just blown up. Echo ult to get out of that, but here comes the Coco from the flank. The Coco will just wreck Ezreal. What a huge amount of damage on that Pick-A-Card with the Lich Bane.
That was Pick-A-Card, Lich Bane, stack deck into an instant one-shot.
Wow. Impressive. It's like, how do you like one-shotting people now, Sasin?
Feels bad, man.
There we go. Coco. Just keep on moving through, zoning out with his utility and his crowd control. Coco's going to get on, but there, not much hope. His space is there to blow up catch him. CJ Antis will take the last two games quite convincingly to complete this series 2-1 after falling down to Spenu with their sub roster in the first game.
Yeah, the strategy of throwing in the Goon Squad to try and pick up a win didn't work. Three substitutes, certainly too many. Maybe one or two, and they could have made it competitive. But credit to Spenu. Once again, that's three series in a row that they've won a game. It's just the moment that the real guys came in, the moment that the substitutes were out of the lineup, CJ Antis looked comfortable in both their victories.
Yeah, they did. Taking a look at this replay on our monitors right now, we're watching Sasin's health bar off of stack one
deck.
Car. There's the stack deck. It was 4/5 of his health.
He has 600 health after that. And remember, this is a level 17 as well.
584 health out of over 2,000, 2007.
So that was an auto attack
three
that
quarters
did
of his
1,500
life.
Damage auto attack.
And stunned him.
Are you sure that Twisted Fate's not the champion that Riot needs to look at?
Yeah, finished off with one wild card after. Wow. Well, that was fun.